This is a HeadGum Podcast.
Jerry Seinfeld's eponymous sitcom is considered by many critics the apex of its form, the Sopranos of multicams. So in 2007, a decade after the series finale, when Seinfeld finally returned to narrative comedy, many were surprised his chosen project was to co-write and star in an animated film about a bee. Bee Movie, a pun as sweet as sweet, sweet honey, told the story of Barry B. Benson, a litigious bee who dreams of fucking a human lady. In a 2007 interview with Rotten Tomatoes, Seinfeld answered the question everyone was asking, why? Simply with, quote, "I just wanted to do something different," end quote. Upon release, B-Movie proved a mild hit, though far from the pop culture sensation of its DreamWorks Animation stablemate, Shrek, let alone the sitcom Seinfeld. But it did provide another data point in our shifting cultural relationship with that black and yellow insect we love, and love to hate, the bee. For much of history, mankind has loathed its fearsome stinger while coveting its precious honey. But as climate change and growing waves of extinction pulled our delicate ecosystem into focus, the centrality of bees and pollination transformed their public image. And it was this noble, selfless, hunted, and exploited bee, whose hives must be preserved for life to sustain on Earth, that inspired both Bee Movie and a vegan burger concept founded in 2019 by Wall Street financier turned animal rights advocate Adam Weiss, who named his fledgling restaurant chain after the winged wasp relative. As quoted in a Fast Casual profile by Pat Shea, Weiss said, quote, "I can't help but appreciate their importance as pollinators and how they naturally go about their business helping crops grow and beautifying our planet," end quote. And like Seinfeld, Weiss's pro-bee advocacy is couched in humor, with cheeky marketing and menu names meant to provide an opening to vegan-curious omnivores. Today, Jerry Seinfeld is reuniting with his fellow B-movie screenwriters Spike Ferriston and Barry Martyr for the upcoming Netflix film Unfrosted, The Pop-Tart Story. And as for Weiss's plant-based burger chain, with a popular location in Los Angeles and a sister store soon to open in the Big Apple, this emerging player is creating its share of buzz. This week on Doughboys, Honeybee Burger. Welcome to Doughboys, the podcast about chain restaurants. I'm Nick Weiger, along with my co-host, Timothy Chalamayonnaise, the spoon man, Mike Mitchell.
Chalamayonnaise.
Chalamayonnaise.
What was this, too?
I'm just giving a little, like, hey, the show's starting. It's a big show. I do that sometimes.
Yeah.
Gesture sometimes. Mitch is referring for our audio listeners. I had my arms outstretched. So I was like, kind of like, hey, here's the show. We're starting the show.
Yeah.
But probably what it was that my tone didn't match the gesticulation.
Yeah,
kind of like
I think that was
more
part
like,
of the
welcome
issue.
To Doughboys, the podcast.
But I'm also used to that with you in many ways. Yeah.
Peter from Nashville sent that roast in. I have to give credit to my buddy and fellow listener Travis for this idea, but it needed to be submitted. Roastspoonman@gmail.com.
Nashville. We've been down to Nashville.
We've been to Nashville.
The it's
Nash.
Nice. The Nash.
Down in Nash.
Walking with our feet 10 feet off of Beale. The old...
Isn't that Memphis?
Oh, fuck.
Those cities don't like
you
each
know
other.
What?
Did you know that? Cities do not care for each other.
It's
There's
fucking,
a Tennessee divide.
It's fucking Memphis.
It's Memphis, yeah.
It's walking in Memphis. It's Mark Cohn? Is that who sings it?
Sounds right.
I fucked it up bad.
No, you're fine. Don't overthink it.
No, it's bad.
It's not bad.
It's real bad.
Nashville, so when we were in Nashville, our
Tennessee's-
buddies... Your Kickstarter sucks. We went out and we're like, oh, I was like, hey, let's go watch a Grizzlies game. It was during the NBA playoffs.
Mm.
You go to bars, like, we don't fucking show that. Like, they put on like one TV of like eight TVs. It's like a sports bar. And then Jesse Farrar was like telling me, he was like, yeah, they don't like Memphis here.
Really?
It's like San Francisco and LA. It's like the two cities don't care for each
other. It's not that big of a state.
It's not that
though.
Big of a state, one would think. And it's also like, that's the one professional, there's two professional sports teams in the city, in the the state, rather, right?
Oh, the Thrashers, are they the other ones?
Oh, I forgot about the NHL. Yeah. So there's like an NHL team, there's a NFL team, there's an NBA team. But you'd be like, oh, if I like
Titans.
The NBA and I'm in Nashville, maybe I'll root for the local Tennessee team, but no.
Yeah, if I'm in Dollywood and it's almost 7 p.m., I'm thinking it's time to watch the Grizzlies. That's what I would think.
That's what I would think, but no, it's not how they roll.
You're in line to get on the roller coaster that goes into Dolly Parton's tit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be
the
like...
The thing I told you that you believed, if you remember.
Sounded like a thin attraction that would be a Dollywood. Something kind of kitschy, on brand for her.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Elvis was from Memphis. Maybe they don't like Elvis in Nashville.
That's... How could you not like Elvis?
That sounds heretical to me, but who knows?
You know what? Liked the movie Elvis, and I, you know, and even though it was not even close to what he was like in real life, I liked Tom Hanks' depiction of the guy.
Colonel Tom.
Colonel Tom Parker.
Your number one, a snowman. He's great. He's the best.
I heard that they're like, people are like, he didn't sound like that at all.
Yeah, it's like he's, Tom Hanks was like doing a sketch character and committed to it. No one wanted to give him a note.
My mom comes tonight, Wise. I told you that.
That's right. As of this recording, this episode will be coming out later.
Mm-hmm. I got Resident Evil 4 remake last night.
You're really timestamping this.
Who cares?
I'm just saying,
gonna be a few weeks. People are still going to be buying Resident Evil 4 remake in like 3 weeks or whatever.
It's just your ability to be like, hey, with this episode's not coming out like tomorrow, but like, let's just make sure we know exactly what day it was recorded.
My mommy is coming tonight.
Yeah, your mom is coming. Resident Evil remake is out today.
It came out last night.
You can figure out what exact date this all transpired.
But I'm already pissed because I know that she's going to like yell at me for playing video games. It's funny that she's coming when a new video game has come out. I'm going to get yelled at. It's going to feel very much like I'm a kid again.
Michael, what are you selling to the merchant? Michael, don't catch La Plaga.
Oh, the chainsaw guy. You have to run around for a few minutes before it moves on.
Michael, don't try to confront the chainsaw guy. He's not exactly a boss in the traditional sense. You're more supposed to avoid him.
Which is fucking... I forgot about that.
Yeah, he'll chop your fucking head off.
He really... The game is tricky.
It's an all-timer.
It's an all-timer. You know what? When I was playing it, I was like, I don't know if this does the update well, and then I played it for another hour, and
it's like, it's fine. I've only played the demo at this point, but you know what else? If we're talking video games, I just finished Metroid Prime Remastered.
Wow.
That's a fucking A-plus remaster.
Yeah.
They just absolutely nailed it. It mostly looks and feels exactly like a modern game.
Can I ask you a question?
No.
When they revealed Samus as the lady at the end, did you nut?
I was like, this is bullshit, man. I was playing a chick the whole time.
All right, Wags, here's a little drop. We've made our guests sit through fucking dog shit for far too long. Here we go.
This is new.
Here's a little drop. Hey, Dope. Oh, wait. Wags, here's a little drop. What was I doing?
You were reading the
email first.
The email about the drop.
I've never done that. Wags,
you're
anyways,
in your head.
Here we go. Here's a little drop.
Carlsberg, oh Carlsberg, Trump has won Carlsberg, Trump has won Carlsberg, Trump has won the state of Carlsberg.
You know what? I mean, the lyrics are nonsense to anyone who doesn't listen to the show,
yeah.
And our guests are probably like, what the fuck does that mean? But that was a great song.
Nice little ditty. Very sonorous pipes on that singer.
It makes sense. Hey, Doughboys et al. Glenn Campbell sent me this recording celebrating President Trump's historic 2016 win from his deathbed. I thought now would be the perfect time to send it over, considering Mitch has been texting me every day to workshop his Carlsberg pilot. Thanks, Seagulls.
Wow, Seagulls.
Seagulls, musician. So it makes sense.
Yeah. Musical artist, one of our musical fans.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't know why people who like audio professionally want to listen to this show.
That's a great question.
Guess it's like what not to do. I'll listen to the Doughboys.
I don't understand why people who are like talented or funny or like want to listen to the podcast or take part in the podcast. I don't know what people who aren't even creative at all want to have any part to do with it, anything to do with the podcast, but they do for whatever reason. And
God
speaking of which,
you.
We got a funny, great, talented guest today.
Mitch, very excited about today's guest, an actor and comedian from Mythic Quest and Drunk History. He's got a new special, Spiritually Filthy, which is now available on YouTube. Mort Burke is here. Hi, Mort.
Hey, what's up, dudes?
Mort, thanks for being here.
Thanks for making time for us. Mort, and Mitch, I don't want to embarrass either of you.
Mort and Mitch.
It's Mort and Mitch. It's a good duo. It's a good duo. Look
okay,
it.
That's very fun.
Yeah. M&M. That's a food.
Mm-hmm.
Something to think about. I don't want to embarrass either of you. Mort, you and I don't know each other. We met for the first time today. You seem like a lovely man. We have not just you on the show. I think we have your number one fan in Mike Mitchell. Mitch has been gassing you up like a NASCAR pit crew. He's been talking you up so much.
I said, Mort's very funny.
Said, Mort's so funny. Yeah. Mort's so, be so great on the show. We got to have Mort on. And we're excited to have you here. So thanks so much for making time for us. But I thought you should know, you have a huge advocate in Mike Mitchell.
I love Mike Mitchell. We have definitely lower expectations, for sure. Like, bring it way the fuck down. Way down. Sorry. But I love Mike Mitchell. He's a wonderful, he's a beautiful gentleman. I do, and I hope this isn't presumptuous, dudes. Mm. But I would like to, if I was thinking about, I want to give myself a Doughboy's nickname.
Please.
Please, yes.
I got two.
Okay, great.
One good one, one bad one. You want the good one
first? We'll probably like the bad one more.
We'll like the bad one, yeah.
Okay, the bad, my name is Mort Burke. Uh-huh. The bad one, Mort Burp.
I kind of like the bad one.
Not bad.
Mort Burp is pretty good.
Because you burp when you eat something.
Yeah, that's okay, cool. That's pretty big.
You got it. All right.
I think that I have a front runner so far, but let's hear the good one.
Second one, Fork Burke.
Also good.
That's also good.
Pretty good, right?
That's also good.
I don't want to put a hat on a hat here, but Fork Burp.
Speaking of hats on hats.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
you
hilarious.
You came in wearing a hat on a hat, and you didn't realize you had it on.
So Mitch just fully docked the day of record. So you know that this we're recording this the exact same day we recorded Red Dead Redemption, which came out a few weeks
Who
prior.
Who gives a shit?
I'm just saying. So what I do is we have our own strategies for these video podcasts, which is that I bring a change of clothes if we're going to record more than one in a day.
Insane.
And so, I think it's just like, hey, it just kind of adds to the, whatever, it's a performance. I'm like, hey, I got a wardrobe change. So
variety.
It feels like a different show.
I get it. Yeah.
A little variety.
Sure.
You just wear the exact same thing to every record. So...
You've which is the cooler move. That's like what like Brian Wilson would do. That's like full genius move.
Yes, it is. It's on another level. But yeah, you got a flannel shirt and a Celtics hat.
I do got to say that this is even because I'm not wearing my hoodie that I wear almost every single day.
Yeah.
But I like this this kind of, this is kind of a Brian Wilson sweatshirt he's got.
Yeah, dude. So yeah. Kind of got a little you know, kind of a tie-dye-y sort of vibe. Not exactly, but I got a compliment from Amelia.
I feel like you might get murdered by the Mansons tonight or something. It feels like
very modern, almost like Hypebeast kind of like Supreme Row era, you know?
I can't quite pull it off, but the dorky story behind this is that I was down by the Santa Monica Pier and it was very windy. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm cold. And so I just went to Nordstrom and I saw there was a hoodie on sale and it was this one. And I was like, I'll wear this.
At any point, did you think like, maybe I can't pull that off? Or were you like, yup?
I immediately thought I maybe couldn't pull it off.
Okay.
But I've gotten compliments on it since. So I'd be like, I'm just going to kind of roll
with
this.
You know what? You pull it off.
God bless you.
And
thank you so much.
That sounded like an insult. That's what I love about LA is like, wear whatever the fuck you want. You know what I mean? We're watching
this. I didn't take it as an insult, but I think it is also funny for an insult to... He should have thought if he couldn't pull it off. Like that should have gone through his mind.
Yeah, I have that thought all the time, constantly.
Would have been a great Manson family member. Because they would have been like, he was the most chilling of all. He didn't say much.
Yeah.
But he was like there in the back. Like, I feel like he would have fit in great in that.
She was already dead, but he took the knife and like stabbed her anyway. So I'd be like that guy in Helter Skelter. Holy shit. Jesus Christ.
They're like, let's cut her head off. Like, we don't need to.
No, we're fine. We wrote pig
we're
and blood
Mansons,
on the wall.
But God.
Calm the fuck down. To explain your hat and hat thing, yes. So I bring a wardrobe change. I had my second hat of two on top of the hat I'm wearing now, just to like, and you were like, you're wearing two hats. I wouldn't have noticed if you hadn't told me.
Yes. Which I was very upset with myself that I did tell you.
Yeah.
Because it would have been funny for you to have two hats on now and not notice. It would have been good.
And with that, with the two hats and that sweater, you look like you were in the middle of a mental health crisis. Like, I'm pretty serious. Like the fans would have been like, we're pretty worried about it. And rightfully so, because it was really,
He looked like the wacky member of the Manson family.
Yeah. Even they weren't sure about this.
Well, you can't join.
A little goofy.
We heard there was a lot of stuff we were talking about before. Casey, I was asking because Mort skates sometimes. I was asking Mort about skating.
That's right, skateboarder.
I was like, when is the end date for skating? And then Casey told us this horrific story where he broke his sternum.
Broke my hip.
I can't believe how wrong you got that. I cannot believe you went to sternum from a hip. He told us about walking on a broken hip.
They're close. You had They're close. They're close.
Casey, I'm sorry. I don't want to make you retell this story, but you, it is an amazing story.
Yeah, it's wild.
So I used to skateboard, and then, you know, the pandemic hit.
Mm-hmm.
I used to skateboard years ago.
Yeah.
Like at skate parks and stuff like that. Then the pandemic hit, just trying to get outside, do stuff outside. Decided to go back to the skate park, see if I still had it. I do not still have it. Went up on a 6-foot vert ramp, just trying to do a real basic trick. Lost the board and just fell in such a weird way. Broke my hip.
Broke his sternum.
Shattered his sternum.
Shattered sternum.
Was unaware that it was broken for 6 weeks.
You were in pain, but you didn't know exactly what was causing it.
I knew I fell skateboarding.
Yeah.
Fallen skateboarding before. I was like, okay, yeah, it sucks, it hurts, but I'm walking around, so it'll get better.
Yeah,
and
then
it
when you went to
getting
the
better.
When you went to the doctor 6 weeks later, you said?
6 weeks later.
The doctor was like, how are you walking?
He was shocked that I was walking. He said he'd never seen anyone walk on
that
a broken hip before.
Broken hip on the x-ray, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wild.
So you're only you're the toughest man he'd ever seen.
That's my takeaway. And I will carry that to the grave.
Which, like, you had a grandpa's injury, but you're being really strong.
Yeah.
How was your sternum?
My sternum's fine.
Okay, all right. It's good follow up. I feel like.
Yeah.
But also, I guess that kind of puts the end date, because I was saying to you, like you think, like I've seen like 80-year-old men skiing or whatever, and women. I'm saying like I've seen like people in their 80s skiing.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen like older skateboarders. But it's a young sport.
Yeah, it hasn't been around for that long, since like what, the late 70s, early 80s, basically, when it came to fruition. But also, I think you can speak to this, because I haven't been on a skateboard in over 20 years, but you're someone who skated recently.
Mm-hmm.
If you limit what you're doing, like you're not doing ollies, you're not trying to, you know, you're not going catching air, you can probably be a little safer, right?
Yeah. I like to keep it low impact. I'll do the occasional ollie. A manual is like a wheelie trick. So you can do those on what they call islands, which are little tiny curbs, basically.
Okay.
So even that, it's like I was skating home. But I had cookies in a bag. I went to go get some cookies. And
that's fun.
Yeah, it was going to be a beautiful day. And I tripped. And it is different. Like, your body just bounces off the ground. And I like, sprained my wrist. And
oh,
I was done
God.
For, like...
Jesus.
See, the pain is really different when you're in your, like, early 40s. You know what I mean?
Oh, just like, the idea of, like, falling on cement. Like, a thing that I did a lot as a kid and scraped my knee or whatever.
Yeah.
It's like, that could end it. That could be it. I might not ever get up from there. But I will say this. If I'm skateboarding, I want to get air. It's not worth it to me if I'm not getting air.
And people know that about you, dude. That's what people say about Mitchell. Like, don't hand him the deck.
Dude, I need air. Yeah. That's why I'm staying away. If I'm not getting air, I'm just going to stay
away. What's the point?
That's right.
Mort, I have a follow-up question. Were the cookies okay?
The cookies were fine.
Wow.
That's
huge. Sacrificed my body in order to, like, protect the cookies.
Where were the cookies from?
This was a grocery store that was close to me when I live in Westchester.
Okay.
I don't remember what cookies they were, or even why I was so specifically, like I remember it was very intentional. I needed to get cookies, but I don't know why. Maybe I was depressed. I don't know what was happening.
That cookies should be good when you're depressed.
Yep.
It also brings up a good subject, but first, Westchester is that a Chicago suburb? Or?
No, sorry. So it's by Inglewood. I lived out there for a little while in LA, and then...
I should have known that. It's close to my city. But why? Because it brings up a very great point that you should ask our guest about cookies.
I think we've retired that. I'll ask it.
Fuck.
Again, because of where we're recording this a little out of order, the bit will have been retired by the time this is out. I'll ask you.
Okay.
Is Christmas a cookie holiday?
Mort, you are the last person to be asked.
You're the last person to be asked this.
Is Christmas a cookie holiday? Traditionally, for me, no.
Wow, a no.
I fucking love it.
The book closes on no.
The book closes on no. You heard it, folks.
You heard it.
Christmas
is
not
a cookie
holiday. It's done.
Done.
Boom. Because we weren't even a cookie family growing up,
right.
Really. So, we weren't even, I don't know, cookies. Yeah, not really.
Wow.
Yeah. But so you feel yes.
No, I feel I'm a soft no.
Okay.
We're
soft I'm, no, soft, I'm, soft
I'm,
no.
I'm collecting data, guess. But now today it feels like the book is closed on no.
No, it's
close
no.
The book.
It's yeah. An official no.
It's official no.
I want to step back a second, which is that you spent time in Chicago, which is a big food city, but you're also from St. Louis, which has some foods of its own.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I want to ask you about
barbecue. Mm. We're talking ribs. We're talking. The weird pizza that they have in St. Louis.
Tiny yes. Pizza, thin pizza, yeah.
100%.
Uh-huh. Emo's, it's called.
Emo's. Yep. Emo's is the big one. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The regional one I want to ask you about is one that I have never had in St. Louis, but I've had the chain version of and I'm fascinated by, which is toasted raviolis.
Yo, those are the shit.
Wow. Yeah,
those, I mean, come on. How can those not be good?
That's the thing. So they're, yes, Emo's, Imo's, whatever the pizza, mm-hmm. The gooey butter cake, which you guys mentioned
we
in another episode.
We have talked about the gooey butter cake, yeah.
Which is tremendous. And the toasted raviolis are all like, they're the food you want at the bar at 1 a.m. Like, it's wow. All like, and I say this with love, fat people eating. You know what I mean?
Yeah, right,
it's the
right.
Best. The Emo's pizza is like, there's like mayo and provolone on it, which sounds awful, but it's so good. And the toaster raviolis, there's not much to say because they're exactly as good as you think they are, which is fuck. Great.
We should have gotten really mad when he said fat people are.
We should probably cut that. That's not cool.
There that I want to try. So gooey butter cake, is that always just in ice cream or is it actually just
never?
Yeah.
The never fact is. That it's the fact it's its own separate cake. And I mean, I haven't tried it in ice cream, so I don't know how that goes. But yeah, it's I can imagine.
Well,
as
I'm
like
a fool.
Flavor.
I thought of it. I thought it was more of an ice cream
well,
flavor. I'm an
it's
idiot.
Jenny's because it's Jenny's flavor, but Jenny's obviously borrowed it from the St. Louis delicacy.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's again like perfectly described. It's gooey. It's buttery.
Fuck.
And baby, it's cake.
What do we think the whale would like the most? The gooey butter cake, the toasted raviolis, or the Emo's pizza?
The whale should have maybe moved to fucking St. Louis.
He just go out and about and be like, oh, hey, it's the whale. What's up?
Are you referring to Brendan Fraser's character from the movie The
yeah,
Whale?
Okay. Yeah, the whale, the titular whale.
That's the whale.
Okay, yeah. Great. That's like my brother does this when he watches Die Hard. He calls John McCain. He calls the main character Die Hard all the time. Come on, Die Hard. It's the best move.
I saw the whale eating a fucking gooey butter cake down by the arch.
Yeah.
Fucking just...
Looks good.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah. Healthy, happy.
Where was he? Was he in Idaho or some
He's
shit?
He's in Idaho.
Fucking Idaho?
Should have been. It would have been fine in Idaho.
He should have been fucking in St. Louis. I think that the whale would like that gooey butter cake.
Honestly, probably, yeah.
Come on.
Now that I'm here, like, is it warm?
Yeah, you can eat it. You can eat it. You can eat it either way. Actually, you can get it straight from the store, and you could also like even put it, drop it in a microwave for a little bit, steam it up a little, because that gooey it gives you the, what is it? It's like it's its own kind of moisture. If that makes sense, you know how like tiramisu or something
is like
a moist cake. It's kind of like that shit.
Should I email our touring agent and asked to
go to St. Louis?
St. Louis?
Maybe.
I mean, there's Emo. Is it Imo's or Emo? Emo's?
There's a joke that no one knows how to pronounce it. We called it Imo's. But honestly, Imo's. You know what else is fun about that pizza? Is that you can eat like, it's their small little cracker-sized slices. So you can eat 40 slices, which makes you feel like a giant.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? How you're like, I ate all the pizza.
Yeah, so. Makes you feel like the fucking whale.
We're going to go to Imo's.
I just had 40 slices of pizza. Read my daughter's essay. Right, the whale. Calm down.
We're at Imo's and we're like, look at it over there. It's the whale. He's at a table with Nelly. It's Nelly and the whale.
Oh, yeah, of course they'd be friends.
Yeah, they're friends.
That makes sense, yeah.
Fun Nelly fact.
Yes?
Amazing bowler.
Wow.
Weird. Isn't that the last thing you thought I was going to say?
Wow.
Yeah, we just had the bowl tournament, and Nelly was an amazing bowler.
That's amazing.
How about that? That's amazing.
Bowled like a 300. There's this kind of famous bowling alley there called the Pinup Bowl, and he bowled a 300 there.
Wow. That's fucking rad. The Nelly fact that I know, I think it's the right player, but that he was another guy from St. Louis, the NBA player Bradley Beal.
Okay.
Nelly was Bradley Beal's babysitter when he was a teenager.
What?
Isn't that wild?
Here's Nelly was Bradley Beal's babysitter?
Yeah.
That is wild.
Well, I can't
see Nelly being a babysitter. Well, I'm in the babysitting club. I was a babysitter at one point.
Mm-hmm. But if you do the age math, it makes sense.
He's like,
he would have been a teenager when he was a kid.
You always had a Band-Aid handy too if the kid needed it.
Yep. Singing to him, hey, you can find me.
That was, I made a 1998 joke about Nelly's Band-Aid.
I liked it. I was so in for it. It didn't even occur to me that someone wouldn't get that. Yeah.
Nelly is singing the essay to the whale.
That's crazy because Michael Jordan was my babysitter.
Get what? The fuck out of here.
No.
Oh,
no.
God damn it.
Sorry, I was
lame. God
totally
damn it.
Believed it. 100% buy.
Does a lie count as a joke? That's what I was
using. Yeah, I think it does.
Yeah, I think, yeah, 100%. Okay, cool. I mean, fucking
it
better.
Works for us. You know, here's a Nelly fun fact.
Mm.
Tip Drill, a really horny video I used to watch back in the day.
Sure.
Check it out. You can check it out. I think you can like only find
tip
it
Tip Drill?
Tip Drill. Yeah.
That's
I mean, it must be your ass because it ain't your face. I need a tip drill. That's the lyrics to the song.
And isn't that a reference to a strip club thing that you do where like, I forget specifically, but it's about like.
I think you're right. Where yes, it's basically, yes.
Some kind of move in the
they're
strip
They're tossing
club.
Money at, yeah. Wags, Google, watch it without sound on.
I got it brought up here. I'm watching it at MOS. And yeah, there is.
It is a horny.
It's so horny.
It's a very horny video. It's
there
a
are,
horny
there's
video.
A dugout full of very attractive, scantily clad ladies while a baseball game is going on. Nelly just apparently bunted a home run. Is that what happened?
Yeah, and he did a funny walk-off too with the bat. A
lot of fun. And now panties are being thrown. Oh, no, that's a bra. I'm sorry, a brassiere.
I can tell you this. I remember watching very it horny. At Stocky's apartment in Dorchester, I believe is where he lived. And, after doing some whippets.
sure. That's all this adds up.
That's why I told you when Stocky went to the 7-Eleven and he bought like 10 things of whipped cream and then one little pint of ice cream. And the guy at 7-Eleven was like, you don't have to buy the ice cream. I know what you're doing.
And then he gets back to you and you're like, where's the ice cream?
What the fuck? Morty, there was stuff we were saying out there and you said, save it for the podcast. I'm trying to remember why we were mad at each
other.
Oh,
you guys just had a classic Wags and Spoon Man argument. I can't remember specifically what it was about, but it was just a real like.
What was it about? I was yelling at you at some point.
Yeah, there was yelling.
It's fine. It doesn't matter.
Do you remember what I was yelling?
We don't need to relitigate it.
Well, can we not? Do we not want to talk about it?
I don't remember what
it was. We were talking about sleeping, how we were really into how much sleep Nick was getting, which I'm still, I think, is a good subject. Mm-hmm. And then it moved to something. What?
He said that he loved waking up in the morning.
I do love waking up now,
which is insane.
Yeah.
For a guy who doesn't sleep good. But I was yelling at you in some sort of rhyme. I forgot what I was saying. I was saying, whatever. It doesn't matter. I shouldn't bring up a thing that we were talking about before.
Yeah.
But you love waking up in the morning, which is so weird for a guy who doesn't have normal sleep.
Well, I've gotten into it now because I've established a sleep schedule. Or at least I'm working on a sleep schedule. I'm trying to stay pretty rigid with that.
Yeah.
It's been working well for me.
I have a sleep schedule. This is true. I am in bed before 3 a.m. It's my new
rule.
There
you go.
It is. And it. This is
if
real.
It works for you,
that's
works
good.
For you.
This is real. This is. It's a step in the right direction. Mort, you used to be a late night guy. You said you were.
My whole life has been a struggle with getting to bed before midnight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I am such like a kind of a nocturnal dude, and it's not a it's an early man's world. So you know what
it
I
is,
mean.
It is once you get up there, it's an early man's world.
That's right.
I got a question for you. You're a vegetarian now. You eat fish though as well. You're pescatarian.
Yep.
Yes,
as we found out. We found out the word for it. Me and Wise like, pescatarian. But here's a question for you. Yeah. I think you're gonna like this question.
Okay, great.
And you're not a late night guy.
Yeah, but just before you answer the question, Mort, give me a second to like weigh in on the question.
Whether you like it or not.
Yeah,
sure.
Okay, great.
As a vegetarian / pescatarian, late night eats, a big part of the comedy world we're in, staying out late, getting late night stuff, but as a vegetarian, a little trickier. What do you do in that scenario? Wags, is it a good question?
Mitch, I love that question. It's a great question.
You know what's beautiful about that question, Mike? If I may, Spoon Man, it really opens up the a world that I truly inhabit, which is late night munch zone. What are you going to do? I'll give you this hot tip, which is going to sound insane and gross, but has really helped my life.
I love it.
I'll go to McDonald's. I'll get the Big Mac, no meat.
Wow.
And
that's
wild. And I will tell you this, it doesn't taste that much different from it tastes like a delicious, weird, fast food grilled cheese, large fry. I'll even get a cheeseburger, no meat. Feeling real good. The other thing I do is I'm obsessed with popcorn right now.
popcorn.
Yeah, I make a lot of late night corn.
This is a touchy subject.
Well, I'm a little bit of a popcorn skeptic.
He's a popcorn skeptic. But he went to the theater recently and got a popcorn.
I usually get nachos and then I get a popcorn recently. I was like, this ain't bad.
Nachos are great. Yeah. I hear that. Nachos, that's a more high intensity snack.
It is, and it's more caloric.
Yep.
You know what? You're wrong.
I'm wrong?
Popcorn, if you add butter to popcorn, it is the highest caloric snack you can have. It's like over 1,000 calories easy.
It offsets the cheese in the nacho cheese.
It offsets the cheese big time. I mean,
I think melted cheese is more intense, for lack of a better scripture, than melted butter, I would say.
For sure.
Yes, that melted butter, though, that's the thing, is we've been trying to be healthier, the two of us. Nice. I don't know why I'm speaking for both of us and everything I say, but it's the truth.
It's true.
And we're trying to be healthier, and I am a popcorn fan. Mm. And when I go to the theater now, like a regular size popcorn, here's another crazy thing. They don't, at AMC, they don't sell you anything smaller than, if you want a kid's popcorn, you have to get a kid's meal.
Yeah.
I don't want a kid's meal.
No.
Right.
So if you get so sometimes I'll just eat half of it. A lot of the times I eat all of it, but that regular size popcorn at AMC is 600 calories.
The fucking big boy.
Dude,
yeah.
I don't know why they're so invested in giving everyone heart disease. Like, why is it all you can only have this 40-ounce soda? You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, I don't understand why there's not a smaller option at AMC. It doesn't make sense
at
that
all.
There's not a smaller option.
It's the portion approach. It's the Cheesecake Factory philosophy, which is like, if you increase, you can increase portion size by 50% and only increase cost to the restaurant by 10%.
Mm.
But the customer is willing to pay 1.5 times as much. So it's like it's like pure profit. And the same thing is applied to something like, you know, soda or popcorn. I mean, they're both just corn delivery systems.
Yeah, but
and
the customer,
the cheapest ingredient they have.
The customer is paying in diabetes.
100%. You know? Yes. Yeah, they're paying down the line.
It's bad. It's also I guess it's that sort of thing of like, we set the price point wise, is what you're basically saying. It's like,
yeah,
this is like $7 and that you have to pay $7 for this thing.
Uh-huh. Look at my Yeti mug. Like, if they charge you $7 for this much popcorn, people are like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
But they charge you $7 for a medium sized version, people are like, yeah, all right, I can buy that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It feels like a value proposition to them. But yeah, it is, it's insidious, because we're consuming way more calories than we need to. And Mitch, as you and I have been made aware, as we are trying to eat healthier, a big thing that determines how much you eat is the portion size available to you.
Yeah.
Right. The Unkar-Plutt conundrum.
Mm-hmm. This is the Unkar-Plutt conundrum, which it is, I think, in the diet world. I think they do.
Plutt is a huge influence.
God.
Is this an author? I don't know Plutt. I'm not familiar with Plutt.
Wow, you don't know Unkar-Plutt.
Wow, don't know Unkar-Plutt. Do
he
like,
is
does he go by Un?
I'm sure he actually probably does go by Un.
Yeah.
Casey, I thought there was a light that reflected. I thought Casey was giving us the light.
We're 29 minutes in.
This episode's so bad, just slowly turns out the lights and everything.
Casey, you should start, when we're like an hour 40 in, you should start giving us the light. I think it is. I think that would be helpful.
Let's just say he's a pretty big player on Jakku.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Also don't know what that is. I feel it.
He's a character from...
I envy you.
He's a Star Wars character.
Oh, okay, got it. I'm really cool. I should have mentioned that before.
So I honestly,
episode 7, The Force Awakens.
Did you see the new Star Wars?
I saw The Last Jedi.
Okay.
Which I loved.
Okay. I like Last Jedi. Okay, this is going to be the whole thing.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have been singing Mort's praises.
yeah, okay. So, all right. But again, this is coming from a person who's not, like, I didn't see Star Wars as a kid. So it doesn't have that same, it doesn't have, we didn't have a VCR growing up.
Wow.
I'm very poor, which makes me noble.
What were your pop culture touchstones as a kid?
I did get to go see E.T. in the theater and Ghostbusters. Ghostbusters too. So that was like a huge, absolute revelation. Yeah.
The Ghost, I remember seeing Ghostbusters as a kid, but I specifically remember being in the theater for Ghostbusters too. I'm pretty sure maybe I didn't see Ghostbusters 1 in theaters. What year was that? 1984?
I think 1984. I think we might have been a touch too young.
Too young. Yeah. I was maybe a touch too young at that point.
So you saw it first, like on the TV at some point?
Yeah, I saw it. I mean, and it was like one of my favorite movies. I do remember seeing Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles in theaters.
Big.
Definitely remember that.
Yep.
Going nuts over it. Those were the two big ones. Why? I'm sure, actually, this is probably something we can all relate to. I had He-Man toys, but I was kind of like the end of the He-Man cycle. into Ghostbusters, Ninja Turtles toys. Those were the big ones. I mean, like, I was first, I had like dinosaur toys as a boy because I liked like just actual no name dinosaur toys.
What's your favorite dinosaur?
As a boy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was the Brontosaurus.
Oh, interesting.
Mort, favorite dinosaur?
I would say I would go maybe T Rex, I guess. I don't know.
Casey, dinosaur favorite?
I like the guy that goes like this.
Dilophosaurus.
With the neck.
Dilophosaurus.
Oh, the Jurassic Park.
Is it Dilophosaur or Dilophosaurus? Yeah, in Jurassic Park.
You're the dino guy.
He kills fucking Nedry.
Yeah,
I think it's the Dilophosaur.
Yeah, that's a sick dino.
And also, Back to the Future, I saw at a friend's house, which I think really influenced the skateboard thing. Also.
Oh, sure, yeah.
It was like
Marty McFly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah.
Yes, that I feel like maybe I saw Back to the Future 2 in theaters. I saw 3 in theaters.
Uh-huh.
Or wait, did I see Milo and Otis? I maybe saw like an animal movie, and then my sister saw Back to the Future 3 in theaters. I forget. Anyways.
Do y'all remember there was a period where, because Back to the Future 2, they have the hoverboard sequence, mm-hmm. which I thought was like, this is the most amazing thing I'd ever seen. I was fascinated by it. But
also people talked about how, I remember in elementary school, like for a science fair project, which is like a dumb kid science fair project.
Yeah.
I made a hoverboard, and it was just like, it was like a tube with a magnet and then another magnet and like a cutout picture of a guy on the magnet. Like that's like,
okay.
That's how I figured out how hoverboards work. Like that's how it could work is magnetism or whatever was what I figured out.
That's cool though.
Yeah. I think that's brilliant. I don't think that's stupid at all.
Oh, well,
I think that's creative and insightful for a young man.
Thank you. I mean, I turned that project in middle school and in high school.
He tried to show it to me when I got here.
Yeah, I bring it with me everywhere I go.
Kind of sad.
But that was like, people said like, there's going to be hoverboards in like
that's
10
what I was
going to
bring up. Yeah,
yes,
kids were always talking about it. It was like, my uncle, like you say, like he's been on a hoverboard. It's like real.
The bummer to me is that so much of the Back to the Future 2 technology hasn't come through. Like, the dehydrated Pizza Hut pizza, we never saw that. That's fun.
Mm-hmm.
That would have been great. And close, but it's crazy that it still doesn't happen, is like video calls. I'm so shocked that Apple just hasn't done that, like made an Apple TV where you're just like, it's a video call and then someone is on the video. I mean, like.
Well, you can do that,
right? I mean,
right?
It does happen now, but I'm saying like, it's just weird to me that hasn't been implemented like in the home where like someone is calling in and just comes up on your TV. I guess
people are used to being on their phone is the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what is the futurist stuff? I guess Cubs win the World Series. That
Which
one did
come
happen.
True.
That right. one happened.
Mm-hmm.
Then a later Jaws that was in 3D. Right. There was a 3D Jaws, but I think it came out before the movie.
A lot of people have made the comparison of Biff to Trump and
that's
his
right.
kind of his
the
rise
alt
to power.
Future is very much the alt present is like where Biff is in charge of everything felt Trumpish.
Yeah.
And Crispin Glover was really opposed to that ending. Did you guys know that he talks about that now, where he's like, he felt it was only celebrating like capitalism as like success is the only thing that makes people of value.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then he
got
in a fight. Yeah, it's kind of interesting, right? He got in a fight because who directed it? Was it Zemeckis?
Zemeckis.
Yeah, he got in a fight with Zemeckis about it, apparently.
And then he didn't go back for what?
Is
it the third one that he's not in?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or is it the second one that he's not in?
He's only in the first one.
I think
it's different dad, different girlfriend, and
from
2 on.
I think that's maybe why. I don't want to be talking
that's
out of school,
wild.
But I think they had it. Yeah,
that's wild.
In a row.
He kind of makes a good point. Also, like the technology to go back in time and like get like see your mom like your age and getting horny about it, that hasn't come around yet.
Yeah, yeah.
But it will. They'll definitely.
You're optimistic. They'll figure that out.
That'll be the first thing everyone does when time travels. I'm gonna get horny for my teen mom.
All right, look, we got a lot to discuss. That's not Back to the Future Part 2. We're gonna take a break. We'll be back with more Doughboys.
What's up, everybody? It's your boy, the Spoon Man, and I want to talk to you about today's sponsor, Smalls. You know, there's something I didn't like about my old cat food wags.
What's that, Mitch?
It stunk.
Wow.
It didn't get delivered right to my door.
Wow.
And my cats didn't even like the stuff. That's right. My cats didn't even like the stuff.
And you were always smelling like cat food.
I was always smelling like cat food. And you know what? It didn't taste that good either.
Mm.
I tried it. Cat food has been the same forever, Wags. It's time for cat food to move into the 21st century. Now, do you remember how stinky and smelly my old cat food was? I used to leave the house, and like you said, I smelled like cat food.
I jumped ahead in the copy. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah, you smelled like cat food all the time.
And the cats, there would be just an army of cats following me around because I smelled like cat food.
You'd be like the Pied Piper of cats.
Mm-hmm. Well, guess what? That's not the deal
Piper.
Anymore. I was the Pod Piper of cats. That's not the deal anymore. That's why you got to try Smalls, and you too, Wags. It's 2023. Are you still feeding your cat kibble? Now is the time to update your cat food with Smalls. Smalls cat food is protein-packed recipes made with preservative-free ingredients you'd find in your fridge, and it's delivered right to your door. You don't got to leave. Smalls was started back in 2017 by a couple of guys home cooking cat food in small batches for their friends. Today, Smalls has served millions of meals to cats all across America. How cute is that, Wags?
Adorable.
At this point, you might be wondering, why can't I just feed my cat kibble? Huh? Why can't I just give him kibble? Man, I want to give
him kibble. That's what I'm wondering. Why can't I just feed my cat kibble?
Well, believe it or not, your cute kitty descended from ferocious desert cats who hunted live prey for food, and your cat isn't any different. They still need fresh, protein-packed meals to be at their best. Other cat food brands know this, but they choose to put their wallets first. Capitalism at its finest. Pah!
Don't get me started.
They fill their food with mysterious meat byproducts, artificial flavoring, and preservatives with names I don't even want to try to pronounce. If that sounds gross, imagine having to eat it every day like me and Wally and Irma did. After making the switch to Smalls, 78% of cat owners reported their cats had shinier and softer fur, and 90% reported overall health improvements. That's a big deal. The team at Smalls is so confident your cat will love the product that you can try it risk-free. That means they will refund you if your cat won't eat their food, Wags.
Now, Mitch, I want to hear about your experience feeding your cat Smalls. Why do you love Smalls?
Wags, I like Smalls because it comes to my door. I know my cats are eating good food and their coats are shiny. And I'm feeling their coats and I'm rubbing their coats. I'm liking touching their fur. I'm liking petting those soft little kitties. I'm liking it when they're between my legs at night. I love them.
Remember, higher quality ingredients mean a healthier and happier life for your kitty. So head to smalls.com/doughboys and use promo code doughboys at checkout for 50% off your first order plus free shipping. That's the best offer you'll find, but you have to use our code doughboys for 50% off your first order. One last time, that's promo code doughboys for 50% off your first order plus free shipping.
Wags, Wally and Irma are part of my family. I love them. They love that creamy chicken. I love them, and they deserve the best. I love my cats, and I love Smalls.
Welcome back to Doughboys. We are here with Mort Burke discussing this week's chain, Honey Bee Burger.
Wow.
Which was founded in 2019 by Adam Y. Smith, who was a Wall Street guy turned vegan guy. Kind of the Sam Simon arc of like he had like a one thing he did and then became an animal activist. That's kind of like seems like what Adam Weiss's whole game is. It is a vegan burger and fries concept.
They're all about that on the stock market, that bull, right? Isn't that the
Bears and Bulls?
The Bears and Bulls. And now he's like, going vegan.
Yeah. Like now save the bears and bulls. Oh yeah, or plants. Yes, plants. Yeah. Now it's plants
leaves
and trees.
Yeah, leaves and lettuce.
There you go. there is one location in LA
leaves?
they had announced it. Yeah, leaves and lettuce.
You pronounce it like there's four F's in that.
Can you ever say leaves? I mean, I know it's leaves.
Yeah. Linguistics is descriptive. Not
can you say leaves?
You can say leaves, yeah. Huh. Toronto Maple Leafs.
Oh.
There you go.
Good
That's
point.
One.
All right, good point.
Interesting, yeah.
But this is the whole thing. There's not a right way to say something. It's like a Reese's. There's not a right or wrong way to say something. There's just descriptions of how people say things.
It is like
that.
A Reese's.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's exactly like
or
a Reese's.
Reese's.
Yeah.
Or a case in point, Mitch.
What is a maple leaf? Like a maple tree?
Yeah, it's like a maple tree's leaf.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Huh.
You know maple syrup? That like comes from trees, and those trees have leaves.
Oh.
you know what a tree is, right? What?
There is a make like a tree and get out of here. Back to the future.
Future.
Mm-hmm.
BTF.
Mm-hmm. Biff.
One location.
Man, Biff is great, huh? What a funny character. He's a very funny character.
Yeah, he is funny, yeah.
So here's the thing about Honey Bee. We were like, does this qualify for our premise? And because it has one location, they were supposed to open a second one in Venice. They did it. They haven't opened it yet. It was announced last year. And they have a second location that's planned for New York. And Mitch, you and I were saying this, not with any sort of pleasure, but We fear that as opposed to three locations, there may be zero locations soon. Because this place kind of feels like it's on a downward trajectory.
Which I think is sad news for our guest, who I think enjoys this place quite a bit.
Yeah, are you a fan of this place, Mort?
I picked it because I do like it. Wow. I generally prefer it to Monty's, which is our other like fast food vegetarian, which I also like.
Like Monty's a lot, yeah.
They got some chicken nuggets over there that are crushing it right now.
Wow.
But I knew you guys had already done Monty's as well. So yeah, I threw this out there. Yeah, I generally like it pretty good. But we'll talk more about that when we get into the...
Well,
I never
had
it before. I actually didn't even know about it.
Uh-huh.
Like you were saying, Weiss, there were multiple locations around the city and two have closed.
Yeah.
So the only one available to me, which we found out, we both went to the same spot.
We went to the same one on La Brea, and in a happening sort of section, kind of the fair adjacent to the Fairfax district in LA. Casey had also never heard of Honey Bee. My wife Natalie had been to Honey Bee before, and I can't remember if I've had it before. I knew about it, but I didn't have a memory of eating it.
Was there one over there by the Los Feliz 3 in like a little stand spot? I feel like that's where it first started, but maybe I'm wrong.
That's Mitch's neighborhood. You'd know more better than me.
Maybe I'm crazy. I think it was like a pizza place. Anyway.
No, wait,
next to Los Feliz 3?
I think maybe it was there for a few years ago.
Totally possible.
I could see that.
Right?
I like that stretch. I love the Los Feliz 3, but also I guess pandemic stuff. I didn't peruse that stretch as much. I love it there. You got the Dresden wise.
Yeah, mm-hmm. A lot going on.
And it had my favorite Greek place was right on that corner which is now Burrito Place. The corner by Los Feliz across from Fred 62's used to be a Greek place.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Now it's a burrito place.
Would you get gyros over there?
All the time. They had a great gyro pizza, Wags. One of my favorite.
Wow. Just
a great pizza. I think it was El Greco, I think was the name of it.
Yes,
I
know what you're talking about.
It was fucking fantastic. Gone. Uh-huh. Another place gone too
here's
soon.
Here's a fusion pitch for you, a fusion food pitch.
Mm-hmm.
Yurito.
I fucking like it. I do.
It's not that far from a regular.
Not that far from regular.
A gyro's almost a Rito already.
Yeah.
Just close that top.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah.
I like it.
Not bad, Wikes.
Burrito.
What I
bad.
Do. So I ordered pickup.
Look, you got feta in there. Let's talk about it quick.
Yeah, let's discuss this.
You got hummus?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Sure.
Tahini.
Yeah.
But I'm, you know what? Maybe the tahini is almost like the salsa. I don't
know. Maybe you throw in some of that, you know, that long grain rice to kind of
get some like jasmine rice in there.
Yeah, throw some of that in there. And then maybe like, I don't know, I could see some chickpeas or something, you know, to kind of like work it as a bean component.
It loses me a little bit, but it's...
I'm just trying to think of it though, in terms of the one-to-one burrito component.
Chickpeas a little dry for you?
Yeah, that could be too dry. That could be an issue.
Mm-hmm. I had a falafel burrito the other day and it was goddamn tremendous.
Wow, that sounds good.
That sounds really good.
Yep, it was great. Right. Yeah. Surprising. So, like the avocado was doing a lot of work. It was really good.
So wait, this was a falafel burrito.
Yes.
So it seems like this idea has already been
done. I'm sure this idea has been done. Yeah.
Yurito, though, I mean, I think that if the naming of the Yurito, which also probably already is done is my guess.
It's a better portmanteau than Sushi-rito.
I agree.
So
have you had those? You
know, no, I have. I can't. They look
repulsive. We were saying that they look gross.
Yeah. Something I love sushi too.
Like biting, I've now like raw fish, but like the idea of like biting into a big burrito of raw fish seems weird.
Yeah, like
I
want to
be able to like discriminate, be decisive about what the amount of sushi that I want. I don't want 100%. A random mouthful.
100%.
Yes. Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah. Because that's the thing. You're eating like a carne asada burrito. And you're randomly like, oh, I got a big chunk of carne asada in that bite. Yep. You don't want the equivalent with like halibut. That'd be very very strange.
That's fucking nasty. I was gonna say this. A thing I like about Honey Bee Burger, it sounds like something Ace Ventura would say.
It does.
I mean, does it not?
Yeah, I mean, try
Honey Bee Burger.
Yeah, when you give it that cadence.
Right?
Of course, undeniable.
What is the thing he actually says that's just making me think of that?
Let me ask you a question.
No!
I think you're thinking Bumblebee Tuna.
Bumblebee Tuna. Bumblebee Tuna.
Honey Bee Burger.
Thank you, Casey.
It sounds similar.
With the crazy mouth. Do the crazy mouth.
Bad. Ace Ventura is so funny.
It is good.
It's problematic. It is not aged well.
Yes, yeah, but it's funny.
That's a movie that have not aged well at all. But
maybe two has aged better.
Maybe,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Worse, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Possibly worse.
Both a little problematic. But
I was
like,
remembering the plot of two. I was like, oh, all right, hold on a second. Probably
oh, that's
not
a lot
good.
Of, no.
In fact, I'm maybe not comfortable with me saying Ace Ventura is funny on camera. I'll just retcon that.
But
Honey Bee Burger,
Honey Bee Burger
is funny.
And he as a character is funny.
Very funny character. Mm. So the I'll say this. The app, which I ordered pickup on the app, and then I grabbed it from the store and then took it to another location to eat. Mm-hmm. The app is kind of crap. It's a little clunky. I don't know if you used it at all, Mitch.
I did not use it at all.
It's
a little wonky. I looked at the menu on there, and it was even wonky looking at the menu. But look, and also, I just for the Yurito, tzatziki, tahini, like one of those has to be. Or what's Zog? What is it? What is the
Zug?
Zug. We found out that one of them is like a right wing term, right?
Yeah.
The way we're pronouncing it is wrong. But Hodgman texted us on how to say it, and I forget. But anyways, that could be good to pour on there too.
Yes.
I'm just trying to think of the salsas. Anyways,
lots of options.
I went on the website and it looked like it was. I mean, a part of the reason why I was afraid this place might be going down.
Uh huh.
Is the website is a little janky. It has those warning signals of places that are in trouble. So
yeah, when I went to pick it up around the lunch rush.
Yeah,
and it would have been too early for you. I was there before noon. There's no way you would have fucking shown up.
I could have gone there before noon.
I mean, I don't know. And I had my meal with a friend of the show, Matt Apodaca. So.
You went with Apodaca?
Yeah, with Apodaca.
So what the fuck? I hope you use the fucking get played fucking credit card, you piece of shit.
Nah, I used the Doughboys card. It was Doughboys business.
Fucking bullshit.
This is classic, guys. It's like I'm in a TV show, you know?
I ordered pickup on the app, and I went during the lunch rush, or, you know, just before, like, when it would have been the lunch rush, one employee there. And she was a lovely person, but she was, like, clearly very harried trying to fulfill all these orders by herself. The dining area had, like, not been, I'm not imputing the worker. It's just like that it was clearly understaffed and the dining area had not been cleaned. There were a bunch of unbussed tables that were just sitting there, like including stuff that seemed to be left over from breakfast. Mm. And I just felt so bad for this person. But very, very hospitable, good service, very friendly.
Probably the same lady that I saw there.
Yeah,
me too, I think. Yeah.
I went for lunch the same day as you.
Yeah, a little later though. What time did you get lunch?
I arrived at a normal lunchtime, 4 p.m. I walked in. I use the get played card. And
do you want to grab lunch after two hours from now?
Yeah,
with me. I'm the same way. I eat a late lunch.
I eat a late lunch. This was a scenario where I went later than I wanted to, but the directions. Here's another thing. The directions brought me behind the building.
So confusing.
A little
confusing. But you know what? Worked out great because there was street. You couldn't park on the street at 4 p.m.
Oh, there you go.
And they let you park behind the building. So I did park behind the building, one of the two spots, but I was like, this is very confusing. Walked around to the front, saw that same lovely lady there at the counter who was, by the time I had gone there, the lunch rush was, it had dwindled down at 4 p.m.
Yeah.
But she was the only one working the counter. There were a few people working the grills and stuff like that. There were like two or three other guys, including another guy who brought my meal out to me. But very pleasant, easy to.
Yeah.
It was easy to order when I got in there. The website's not good, but she was very helpful. She told me what she liked. I was like asking her a few questions, and I went a little wild, I guess you could say. Because
sure,
I'm trying to be better about ordering food, but I'm afraid this place not. I'm worried about this place more.
Okay, sure.
I'm a little concerned too. I will also say part of my issue is
fork burp.
Part of my issue is. I think this menu is a little too sprawling. Mm. Like they have so many options.
Yeah.
And I kind of wonder if they, cause like they also have burritos there, or sorry, B-ritos. That's their version, which is cute.
Mm-hmm.
But I just kind of feel like they maybe have too much stuff.
It kind of seems like you maybe got the year-ritos from that B-ritos. Feels like maybe you just stole that from the.
No, it's a different thing. It's my own thing. It's year-ritos. It's new.
All right, I invented it.
But I am a little worried that they have like, you know, they have like four different versions of the chicken sandwich. They have a vegan fish sandwich, which I'm kind of curious to try. I didn't try. But, you know, they just kind of maybe are maybe have too many things on there. I don't know. Maybe that strategy is okay in the app economy. But more, this is a place you're a fan of. What's your regular order? What do you normally get?
I will normally do the fried chicken sandwich.
Mm-hmm.
I switched it up a little bit this time. Now, I want to say, I want to recount my arrival at this place.
Please
too. Because I was like, first of all, for some, hungrier than I've ever been when I went to go get this food.
Me too. Were you? I was ravenous. Yeah. Wow. When I pulled up, I had a breakfast. I think I had 2 hard-boiled eggs in the morning. You know what? That's a lie. I had, fitting the bee theme, I had some Greek yogurt wags with some raw, unfiltered honey, which I showed you a picture of in our
That's
yogurt.
That's right. We have a group chat.
We have a yogurt text chain. And it looked like, because it kind of looked like a brown, like it looked like mud almost, the honey.
Uh-huh.
But very good. And then that's the only thing I had, that and a cup of decaf coffee. And I was like, by the time it was 4 p.m., I was like, I'm fucking ravenous.
Yep. Yeah.
And I went in there being like, I mean, I want to taste a lot of different things, and I'm also legit very hungry. So I went a little crazy.
I think I had a smoothie and then some sort of like classic LA caught in traffic thing. Mm-hmm. And so when I got there, it was raining very hard, and I couldn't find parking, and I couldn't find the place, and I'm super hungry. So I called the lady, so helpful, so sweet.
Super helpful.
Yes,
she's great.
Super helpful. And she was like my fucking fast food Sherpa, whatever, in this like chicken sandwich journey. Cause like my glasses were all fogged up. I was like starving. It felt very kind of Spielberg dramatic when I got in there. So I was like really, really excited to eat this food. But I have a question for you.
Please.
So is it the large menu, is that the same thing like when you go to a diner and it's like 9 pages and you're like, there's no way they do all this well?
Yeah, I think I know it's a thing that Gordon Ramsay zeroes in on when he goes into a restaurant and yells at everybody.
Mm-hmm.
A place like the Cheesecake Factory can pull it off because that's their whole philosophy. They're just like, more is more, we do everything. But a lot of times, and some like old school delis, they can pull it off. But for the most part, it's like, they're just doing too many things. It should simplify what they do well.
Totally.
It makes it more taxing on the kitchen staff. And the supply side of things, because they got to stock more stuff, but also the customers are subtly driven away because people don't like making decisions.
Yep.
And you get analysis paralysis, just like, I don't know what to fucking get here. I got too many options. So I do feel like they could maybe simplify things a little bit. But so you got the chicken sandwich and this
second
was,
question,
yeah, please.
The Yurito, I think thick pita bread style because I don't know if the tortilla, I love the thickness of the pita wrap for a gyro. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. The thing is that you have to get a lot of pita to like cover up the ends, right? Because that's the whole thing. It's kind of loose. It sort of falls
out. But you know
out.
What? Yep. Fucking figure that out.
Yeah.
That's a big part
of it. Solvable
problem. I want to figure it out.
These people just fucking figure it out.
Fucking figure it out.
I can't. It's maybe it's
fucking
sloppy.
The Greeks.
Figure it out.
The Greeks.
I think the rice is really the binding agent for
yes,
the thing. I really
right.
think that.
Mm-hmm. The rice is a big part
rice
of that.
Rice is huge.
Mm-hmm. I would want the. I know what you guys are saying about the long rice, but I would want it to be soft still. If it's.
Yeah, it should be soft.
Okay, all right. Sure. That's all.
What about we throw in like even more fusion, some basmati maybe?
Hey, I'll never object to any basmati rice.
I'm not gonna object to it, but I, my fear is that it's not gonna be soft enough, the basmati.
Have you had a lot of hard rice, Mike?
Look, I've had some hard rice in my life. There's been I've had a few moments where I've had fucking hard rice.
Yeah.
There's where it's like you're biting into a tooth or something. It's like there's nothing worse than some hard ass rice.
Are you eating uncooked rice, Mitchell? Is that what's going on?
I cook rice.
Are you eating handfuls of uncooked rice?
I'm not.
And think that's what it's supposed to be like?
I'm not eating handfuls of rice.
So I get okay. So
fucking fork burp.
Oh shit. Except I really gave myself the perfect name to be bullied by.
Wait, so go on. You go in there.
Yeah, so I go in there. So I had ordered, okay, I got so much I want to say about this. I had ordered the Nashville hot sandwich, which last time I had it was different. It was bigger than this time. I also got the pickles on the side because I don't know about you guys, but I find pickles, sometimes the taste is a little bit distracting from a sandwich.
It can be. I love pickles, but I know what you're saying.
I do too, but if they're like too vinegary, I feel like I'm not tasting the rest of the sandwich. So I got them on the side, but here's the thing, and I was really sad when I opened the little box because they didn't put any other condiments on the chicken sandwich.
Oh, no.
And I was like, I wish I could have told you guys that I was like doing this for a review show or something.
I actually did do that embarrassing thing because I had such a big order. I was like, this is for a review show. I did it, Wags. I did the Doughboys.
Oh, you said it?
I think that's kind of almost more like honest, though, to let them know, you know?
I did the embarrassing Doughboys thing, and I ordered a lot, but it made me feel better to say it. So, and she was like, "Okay."
I did not give a shit.
She's like, whatever. "Sure, whatever." I had to ask you guys both this. I was looking through my photos. I found it.
Okay, great.
I wondered if you guys saw this sign too, outside of Honeybee Burger. Did you see that sign or no?
Oh my, is it beer o'clock already?
I can't. Let me just read it for myself. Yeah, oh my, is it beer o'clock? Now, what is your issue with this?
There was no issue. I just wondered if you saw the sign. I thought it was a fun sign outside Honeybee Burger.
I don't remember seeing the sign, but it's possible there was a chalk sign I missed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like coat hunched over in the rain trying to get inside, so I wasn't paying.
Yeah, not a great weather day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for me at 4 p.m., it was kind of cleared up at that point. and they put out this, oh my, is it beer o'clock?
Yeah, that's fun.
It's fun. I thought it was for a Honeybee Burger, and I was like, okay, maybe this place is popping off more than I thought. And then you go in there. It has, like I said, it's for me, it was clean, but it also has like the weird vibe of like almost an Apple store or something. It's like a very weird vibe when you walk in the door.
Yes.
That front section almost feels like a dispensary or something. It doesn't feel like a restaurant.
It's not super inviting. I will also say that they had like locked off two of the entrances.
Yes, it was confusing getting in.
There was one entrance, which you would think that like for a quick service place, you want more places to go in and out, but probably because they're understaffed, they can't manage all that.
Mm. But look.
Yeah.
Well, say what you're going to say.
I was just going to say, my thought is I bet most of their businesses take out. I bet almost like the bulk of it is apps.
They were on DoorDash and it seemed like they get a lot of pickups.
Yeah.
None of this matters. What? I mean, it matters, of course, when you're great in the restaurant, but the thing that matters most is taste.
Mm-hmm. Great point, Mitch. Mm.
And I thought it tasted pretty good.
I thought it tasted pretty fucking good, too. Honestly.
Pretty good. And mine didn't even have condiments on it. And I was like, this is still a super edible Sammy.
No.
Tasted pretty good.
It's a really good execution of the vegan burger Shake Shack approximation, which is like a whole sector now. And I'm glad that it exists, and I hope it continues to exist. I got the queen bee. Which Wags. Is double patty, double cheese.
Mm.
We're taste buds.
Wow.
Burp Fork had said this at when we were talking.
It's Fork Burp, please.
Fork Burp said this. He called out taste buds because I was wondering if we got the same
episode.
Thing. We are officially taste buds.
We're taste
I got
buds.
The queen bee.
Yeah.
Also, the name of my sister's Turner boat when she was a youngin.
That's cute.
The queen bee.
The queen bee.
What's a Turner boat?
Yeah, what is a Turner boat? You told me before.
We've discussed this on the podcast. Okay. Turner boat is like a little, and people were like, there's no such thing as a Turner boat.
Yeah,
but
it's
there
like
is
a brand.
Such thing as a Turner boat, but it wasn't the brand. There is like also like a little Turner boat. Like a wooden, my dad built this Turner boat for my sister. He built it by hand. He made my sister a fucking boat.
Wow.
He built a boat. We lived on the water. It wasn't fancy sailing. Don't try to say I'm some fucking fancy sailor.
Uh-huh.
It's not fancy sailing.
Uh-huh. And where'd you get
you
your fancy sailor
suit? You
weren't
in a little sailor suit? Yeah. Like Cracker Jack style?
I was in a fancy sailor suit, but that was my choice. I was singing like, good ship lollipop. And my parents were like, cut the shit. Fucking weird.
We're a blue collar family. Yeah. Like, let me get that lollipop.
Fucking a huge lolly. Wait a minute. We looked away. Now it's a regular size lolly. Working
it's got
on that
more
lolly.
Ribbons on him somehow.
My sister, the Courtney, Beeza, her, you know, that's what my mom called her. The queen bee. Called her the
cute.
Beeza, the queen bee growing up. Still to this day. And I was, Mixter, the Trickster, the Weasel, Wags. You know that.
You were the Weasel?
My dad called me the Weasel.
The Weasel? Yeah, you did?
My dad called me the Weasel.
Wow. Wally Shore's the Weasel?
Wow.
My dad would call me the Weasel. That's what he'd call me all the time.
I love that.
I mean, they knew I've always been the same. I've been a fucking piece of shit my whole life. What the fuck do you want from me?
Michael, you are a wonderful gentleman.
They said it in good fun.
Yeah.
My friend said this to me the other day. Hey, be nice to my friend Mike. You might like him if you get to know him.
Wow.
That's a good point.
Powerful stuff, huh?
You know what? The Hold weasel, my one. Dad called me the weasel. It was a term of endearment. It was like the movie. Never seen it. But I
Weasel
suppose it's similar stuff. But he called me the weasel lovingly. The queen bee, my sister, that was my sister's Turner boat,
yes.
Had a big bee on the sail, which was also made. I went with the queen bee as well, Wags, and you know what? I have a lot of love for that queen bee boat.
Yeah.
In my heart, and I have a lot of love for that sandwich. That sandwich was good.
So I'll say this, because I progressed to the queen bee and just in my tasting experience, because Matt and I also got some sweet potato frots and some classic frots and a side of mac and cheese. So I was having these sides first, and the mac and cheese, like sometimes you have these things and you're just like, maybe this could maybe trick me if I was blind taste. I might make things like mac and cheese the complete opposite of this. It was so obviously like vegan, so obviously like fake cheese. I thought it just tasted like nothing. It was just a gooey paste.
It's funny you say that because I know what you're saying. I also got the mac and cheese taste buds. But I know what you're saying, where I was like, this didn't trick me. But I also didn't dislike it. I think it was more that sort of thing of like, oh, this is warm and gooey, but it's not really doing too much.
Yeah, also possible I got a bad batch. But sure. But I will say that like was the low light for me. Mm-hmm. Like Star Wars, I got a bad batch.
Taste buds, I'll say that I big fan of the show Taste Buds. I think in general they haven't figured out vegan cheese yet. And I think you're right that it's like, it's not terrible, but they just haven't. Like vegan ice cream can be pretty goddamn good, actually.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You know
yeah.
what I'm saying? But the cheese, they're just not there yet.
We'll get
there
to that. We'll get to that. I think that they've gotten pretty close with on vegan American cheese sometimes.
I will agree. And and some food dudes, some people who work in kitchens who have posted on our Discord server, the Dostcord, have talked about how approximating an American cheese for some reason, I don't know if it's just its particular textural quality is a little bit easier than other cheeses.
Yeah.
But yeah, I feel like that their fake American, whatever they're sourcing, is pretty damn good and melts up pretty nice.
So you'll eat regular cheese too, right? Okay, all right.
I'll do dairy and stuff, but and that makes sense because American cheese feels a little bit more like chemically or something.
Yeah, a little more processed, a little more sciencey. But are you do you get the rumblies from dairy? Are you just a straight up dairy dude?
What do you mean? I guess
constitutionally endure?
I'm pretty sure everyone over 10 years old is actually allergic to dairy. We just don't know it. You know what I mean? Like, so if I don't eat dairy, I will eat ton. I eat a lot of regular cheese. I'll
Fork,
say
he was just, he was asking basically, does dairy make you shit? Was basically what he was trying to ask.
Yeah, it gives me terrible poops. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing, because when I have a non-dairy version of something, I have non-dairy ice cream so much more often than I'll have regular ice cream these days, as much as I love ice cream, just because I'm like, it's just not worth the rumblies.
I do lactose-free a lot, because
it's a good move.
Which, if you would have asked Nick 10 years ago if that was true, that's surprising, right? That you're able to just eat, dairy-free ice cream.
Yeah, he'd be like, he'd meet me from the future, and he'd be like, whoa, that's wild. Hey, how's your writing career going? Good?
Also, isn't our mom hot?
Check out my mom right now. I don't like it, but you'll love it.
Listen to this. You got to check out your mom.
Just holding a picture of her mom.
Screaming over a crowd that's not there.
But yeah, I when something does a vegan version of it or a non-dairy version of it and it works like with queen bee, I'm pretty on board with it. Yeah.
I do think there is a version if you were like I just met a version of my younger self. I do think it would be a thing where you would like immediately turn into a corpse, like the third Indian, like your younger self would see you and then like kill himself.
Yes, yeah.
He'd off himself immediately.
Right within moments. You come out with two hats on and he's like, I can't.
Your main creative partner is fucking Mitch. That guy, the fucking dumb guy from the Birthday Boys.
He dressed like a little sailor till he was 15.
In LA. That was like when I first came out here, I was trying to like bring some of Quincy with me. I was dressing up like a little sailor boy. But Wags, when I first came to LA, I remember when I was doing the Ithaca College program, and actually a couple friends who went to Elon, Lauren and Katie, just out here. We had lunch together.
Went to Elon?
They went to Elon and they were in the Ithaca program. This is Musk school.
They majored in anti-woke studies.
Yeah.
How to tweet poop emojis. Yeah.
Which at the Doughboys College, we're also going to teach anti-woke studies. But I remember my first year out here going to like a vegetarian burger place.
Yeah.
And like one of the, and it was right, you know where it was? It was like, go on your way to Universal. It was like Lankershim, and then where Lankershim hits, whatever that street is there that goes up to Universal.
I know exactly what you're talking about. There's an In-N-Out right there.
There's an In-N-Out on that street.
Is that the Ghislaine Maxwell In-N-Out? I think it might be.
I think it might be the Ghislaine Maxwell. There's a Carl's Jr. further
up
the
street.
Yeah,
I know. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that one is. Yeah.
What the fuck is name that street? Doesn't matter.
Barham?
Might
be Barham.
Barham's the next one over.
Barham is actually what it. Oh, maybe is it Lankershim? Whatever. Who cares?
Yeah, is this the worst part of a podcast anyone's ever? If we do 40 minutes on whether or not it's Barham Boulevard.
Hyper specific LA geography. Yes, people love this.
What's the name of? I mean, the Birthday Boys lived off that street forever.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But that so there was a vegetarian place there, and it was like, for me, that was like the first, like I had like seitan, which was scary, chicken nuggets, and a burger, and being like, eating it like it was like completely foreign to me or something, like just being like, whoa, this is like weird, like not ever having fake meat before. And I was 22 years old.
There was
which
also
shows you how different things are from even our generation.
Yeah,
for sure. This was in LA, but also there, some of those old school vegan places have hung around. There'll be like a place just called like the Vegan Spot, and it's like they've got like old school, like, you know, like seitan and tempeh based dishes, but they don't, and then like a black bean burger, you know. It's like they're not using the modern product. It's very different from like what a Monty's or a Honey Bee is attempting, and I think a lot less approachable unless you're someone who eats exclusively plant based.
That's the crazy, it's like this place was one of the early places like trying like not just a black bean burger, but like whatever the patty was made of.
Probably like a Morningstar Boca burger or whatever it was back
which
then.
Which I kind of really do like those black bean burger stuff. Some, not, I know exactly where, I've never heard them describe that old like vegan spot style place. It's so true. But sometimes I miss, like I didn't get the cheeseburger at this place because to me, Impossible Burgers, Beyond Meat, they never quite do it. Like I tend to prefer a fake chicken to a fake meat. And
interesting,
what I like about this one that I got at Honey Bee was that they weren't pretending like it was like a delicious cut of chicken. It was like a small patty with a lot of what I would call hot crispy brown around it.
Right.
And I love that hot crispy brown.
Love it. Look, it's good stuff.
You say hot crispy brown, Wags and I are in. I don't even have to know what it is. I want fucking hot crispy brown.
Sounds like a Rolling Stones song.
Yeah, it's like that Ben Affleck scene in The Town where it's just like, just brings a hot crispy brown. It's like, what time are you going? Like, when are we leaving? I completely mangle it.
We're the Remmer.
Jeremy Renner.
And then whoever the chubby Boston guy was, I'll take that role. All of those vegan food places, and this place I went, which was cutting edge in 2005, now comparatively would look like shit. And I could probably, if I went there, I'd be like, this sucks. But back then it was like the cutting edge place. But I do think that, and I've heard a lot of people say this, but beyond an impossible, a lot of vegetarians and vegans are like, oh, that's so much for like people who don't eat, like people who do eat meat rather. Is like it feels like a big fans of that are people who actually even do eat meat.
Yes, that's why I wanted to ask you more of a follow-up question, which is how long have you been eating vegetarian?
It's a good question, and I'm not sure exactly, but maybe kind of like 5 or 6 years.
So it's been a little bit, because sometimes I feel like, look, exactly what you're saying, Mitch. Once people have kind of settled into eating more plant-based, then you reach a point where you aren't craving like that meat approximation as much. You aren't craving the specific
I still feel, because I have eaten 1 million hamburgers.
Like, sure.
I ate nothing but cheeseburgers for the first 30 years of my life. And
it's very wimpy-esque.
it was. That's the one impression I don't have is a wimpy impression. Otherwise, I'd whip it out right now.
But dude, they've been looking, SNL's been looking for Wimpy for so long. They haven't been able to get the Wimpy on there.
Every time you get your audition or whatever, like, just so you know, if you can get a spot on Wimpy, like, you're haters like try to figure it out.
I've been working the Wimpy at the clubs and stuff. I've been doing Wimpy. And
I saw you. It's bombing.
Yeah, it's not doing well.
Nobody knows what you're talking about.
But I'll pay you a burger today for whatever the fuck he's
doing. He's the Popeye character. I like that chicken place. Like, no, there's a cartoon, Sailor Man.
Fucking idiots.
But I feel like even when I was eating those, even when I was eating tons of burgies, yeah, like Wimpy, I still didn't love the Impossible. I just don't feel like the Impossible has really nailed it for some reason. I feel like
interesting.
To me, they're trying to like chemically fake the like the umami taste of a burger, and it never.
Which Wags and I think love.
I kind of love it. I kind of think the Impossible works for me. I have some Beyond Burger patties from Costco in my freezer that I'll like heat up. Like I'm just like I'm like that. The both of those I think work for me. But I'm also somebody who is not. I had like 1 year, the longest stretch of in recent memory, 1 year where I didn't eat any meat, and now I'm like basically trying not to eat red meat, but occasionally have a little indulgence. Yeah. I'll have chicken. Yeah. I'll have fish. So the Impossible like works great for me.
Yeah,
in terms of where I am,
which brings us to a great point about this place. Mm-hmm. You get the option of Impossible
or Beyond, whichever you like.
And I think that that's interesting. It also makes me be like, which side do they like? And then I asked the woman at the counter. Yeah. I was like, what? I was like, Impossible is the way to go, right? And she was like, yeah. She's like, I prefer Impossible, but she was like, Beyond is non-GMO and gluten-free, which I did not realize. And I guess Impossible is GMO.
Yeah. I saw a chef. Fuck, I wish I could remember which chef he was. He was one of the TV chefs, and it didn't seem like he'd been bought off. It seemed like it was not like it was, he was just kind of talking about why Beyond is better than Impossible, just like from a food perspective. And it was kind of persuasive. I wish I could remember any details about that at all. But I like them both. I'll just say, I think that. Just talking about this place as a business, I think that's another decision point you don't need to have for the customer. I think having both of them, because one of the options of the Queen Bee, you can get one Impossible, one Beyond patty.
I like, should have done it. But you know what? It seemed fucking gross.
It seems
for some
weird.
Reason.
And why make the customer make that decision? Yeah. That's just another place where they're going to be like, I don't fucking know.
Yeah.
Get something else.
Right. Yeah. Wags. If I may call you Wags, taste buds.
Please.
You're thinking about this like a restaurateur, which I love. Because now only when you describe going in how there was an unappealing aspect of the design.
Yeah.
I think that's, I don't know. That's why you're a pro on a pro review show, baby. You're thinking the heart.
I think he's being an asshole. I think he's tearing down this place.
I like this place a lot. I actually had a great meal. The frats we'll talk about.
Yes.
I think the tots are better than the fries, or at least they travel better than the fries.
Yes.
But it's fun to have both.
I ate it in restaurant. You didn't eat it in restaurant?
No, we got it to go. Oh,
okay.
Yeah, but it's fun to have both. I did like the sweet potato tots quite a bit. I like the classic tots as well, which were just with potatoes.
Wait, and were there sweet potato tots?
Sweet potato tots, yeah.
No, I've never even heard of that.
Yeah, it's fun. And those were a lot of fun, and those traveled really well, and they had a great texture to them. And I had those with their dipping sauces. Good house ketchup, decent barbecue sauce, a little sweet for me. Outstanding vegan ranch. Another thing that I think the vegan can do, that you can do a vegan,
you know,
version of it
that's
that really good is ranch dressing. I liked it a lot.
It had like an earthy taste to it.
Yeah.
And it didn't taste 100% like ranch to me, but I liked it.
Those are great dipping sauce.
My three dipping sauces, I went with the ketchup, and I actually kind of, the ketchup was kind of like a tomato-y, not a Heinz, but a tomato-y ketchup.
Yeah, it's a house ketchup.
Yeah, I kind of liked
it. It's pretty good.
It's pretty good.
100%.
And then there was a hot honey. I got the hot honey.
Oh, wow.
The hot honey is fucking good. The hot honey is good. And the ranch I even liked too. I think I liked the ranch-wise, I maybe liked third least, but I liked all of them. I got the Queen Bee. I also got a second sandwich. I tried to get, my plan was to get nuggets, and they did not have any nuggets.
Okay.
Which I don't know if you got nuggets, but
I didn't get nuggets.
They were out of nuggets. So I had the mac and cheese. I got the frots. We'll get to the frots. And then I got a second sandwich, which is why I'm saying I got a lot. I didn't eat all of this food, but I got the buffalo chicken sandwich.
Wow. Uh-huh.
That is the other sandwich I got, Wags. There it is. The
wow,
buffalo
look at
chicken
that.
Sandwich.
And that looks
it's
appetizing
just showing a photo on his
as
phone.
Hell, yeah.
And it was good. It was really good. I enjoyed it. It had some nice heat to it. It didn't like blow me away, but it was,
right.
I mean, like also even the burger, which I love, like didn't, I wasn't like, this is the best I've ever, well, I don't know. It was really good. When I even say it didn't blow me out, both were really good.
They were good. I liked it a lot. I thought it was a really satisfying.
Both were really good. Maybe it fucking blew me away. It might have blown me away.
It certainly came close. Morty, I want to hear more about your meal.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Yes, I'm with you on the fries. To me, there's a texture to them that I love.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like if I would have, because they didn't travel amazing, if I would have gone home and reheated them, I felt like these fries were threatening to be the perfect fry for me, but not
sure.
quite there.
Yeah.
And I can't quite pinpoint why. And I always love tater tots.
Great tots.
I am like a 6-year-old, just, you know what I mean? So goddamn delicious. And to do it together, I think is fun because it makes it easy to not have to decide. That's one thing that I do like. Or they make that decision for you, I guess.
Yeah.
Which is kind of what you're talking
about.
You
get them both.
Get them both.
I kind of love that.
Yep.
It's like a place that sometimes you'll get a place that'll have like, either 50-50 your fries and curly fries or 50-50 fries and sweet potato fries. I love that option. Yeah, mm-hmm. Give it to me.
Yeah, and I got, because I want to get something I hadn't gotten before for the show, I got the hash browns.
Mm. Wow.
Little underwhelming, to be honest. I think it's hard to screw up a hash brown. These were like perfectly edible, we'll say.
What are we dealing with form factor wise?
Great question. Thank you, Wags. Like a rounded rectangle.
Got it. Okay.
Two of them, right? In like the patty, the same kind of paper they wrap the burgers in.
Right.
And like, so the way, and these were crispy and good on the outside, but in the middle, a little like, I would have liked them brown all over. I like that crispy brown.
Yeah.
I would have liked them brown all over. Yeah. These were a little bit more potatoey in the middle.
Yeah.
I love that burger wrapper paper. I would like to see more of that paper around.
Doesn't it make you feel like you're like eating the burger from Pulp Fiction or something?
Yeah,
like,
it's great.
Like a classic move to it.
No, I love it. And also a little bit more eco-friendly for what it's worth.
Mm-hmm,
a little less waste involved.
Mm-hmm.
What, for like a lot of my college essays, mm-hmm. I turned them in on burger paper. It was written on burger paper.
Stain and just poking holes through them.
Yeah, writing with grease, like with a fine point pen.
It's an A+. It's incredible material.
I liked my frots. I liked the fries too, Wags. I actually usually like fries more than tots, personally. But I'm gonna say this. I thought that these tots were a home run.
They're great tots.
The tots were
really,
fucking
really
delicious.
Outstanding tots.
And I kept going back to the tots. I thought the fries were pretty good. Here's a little picture of them. I'll show you the picture. Why not? I'll show the fucking people watching on YouTube.
Wow.
There you go. They can see. They can see the fucking.
Just holding up his phone.
The frots.
Yeah.
There's the frots.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And I was dipping them in that hot honey. I was dipping them in the ranch. Dipping in the ketchup. I was having a good time. I was really enjoying the frots. And also, I think you just said this a second ago, but like, more places should do the frots.
Give me the frots.
Yep.
Give us the frots.
Give me those frots.
Give us frots.
I'm going to move from savory.
Isn't that hard?
Lots and lots of spicy frots.
Is it that hard to make frots?
No, it feels like a doable thing.
Yeah.
It feels like a solvable problem. Totally. I want to move from the savory side.
I'm fucking pissed off over here.
Oh, calm down.
Give us fucking frots.
No one punches through the wall and go.
Is that a Colossus move where I just will run through a wall? I'm fucking pissed off about frots. It should happen.
Once you get them in this form, you're like, yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm really, really happy that you guys like this place.
Yeah.
The food was impressive.
Quality food. Moving from the savory side down to the sweet treats.
Sweet City?
I got myself into Sweet City. I got myself a Blossom Shake.
Is there any place called has a city not claimed Sweet City?
Some place should be
Quincy's,
Sweet City.
Quincy's now Sweet City.
Hershey, Pennsylvania?
That should be like where,
oh,
where Van Halen's from. That should be.
Yeah.
Wait, is Hershey known as like Sweet City?
Don't they say it looks like the sweetest city in the, I don't think they call it Sweet City, but they say something about being
whatever.
The sweetest
if
place
they
in America.
If they don't say Sweet City, Quincy gets Sweet City.
All right, that's fine with me.
All right, good.
Cool.
I think it's good.
All right, thank you.
Canon.
Sweet City.
Call it.
So, from Sweet City, Massachusetts, the Spoon Man.
That's all
Mike.
Like it.
Mitchell!
That's how you get announced that at shows that way. Thank you.
I got the Blossom Shake.
Mm. Whoa.
There you go. I was hoping you'd do it.
Yeah! Now we're podcasting.
This is vanilla soft serve and orange extract.
Whoa.
I'm pulling this from...
Little tiny one?
I didn't say Blossom again.
I was just impressed by the ingredients.
The quote... on the website was, or on the app was, tastes just like an old-fashioned creamsicle. I think it did. Now, Apodaca had this place before, and he had a shake that he said, he had a chocolate shake, which he said was pretty rough.
You gotta try it again on the Doughboy's Dime, interesting.
And so he kind of prepared me for this being a possible letdown. I thought it was fucking great. And I thought it did very much evoke an old-fashioned creamsicle. I was like, this is like that 50-50 shake, which when that's hitting, that's a top-tier shake.
And you know what, Apodaca? I don't know what the fuck goes on in your podcast, but I got a little mini. I got the small version, which is very small, of the chocolate shake. Yeah. And I thought it was fucking fantastic.
Damn. Now, okay, this is hitting on a bunch of stuff, because weren't we just saying we'd prefer smaller options, right?
Yeah.
It's a tiny little delicious
tiny
chocolate
little
chip.
Delicious shake.
And the creamsicle thing, like, that's cool, because that feels to me singular to that, to this restaurant. I don't think a lot of places are kicking out creamsicle shakes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've seen some old school diners that have done it, but it's not like a common thing.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I got to say this. Honey Bee Burger and... Look at that table.
Mitch is showing some pictures of flowers.
The flowers on the table. Come on, that's fun.
Yeah, that's a
sweet
nice.
And fun.
Well,
did you do anything from the sweet side, Mort? I apologize if we missed it.
Okay, so here's the thing, you guys. Mm-hmm. This feels like I'm like coming out. I don't really eat sweets anymore.
Fascinating.
Wow.
And only because I ate like so many bags of gummy bears, Twixes, doing the Nerds, I'm doing anything for so long that I was like, I have to stop. Like, I couldn't eat a little bit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right.
So I stopped eating sweets. I still will eat, like, I'll put, like, honey and stuff sometimes. And I'll like I said, I'll eat a Big Mac, which that's mostly sugar, I'm sure, you know? But I don't, and I will tell this is super crazy. My, like, depression has lessened significantly since I stopped.
Wow.
And again, it was because I think I was eating so much.
Sure.
Like, I was just eating my feelings with it. You know what I'm saying? But so I generally avoid, like, sweet stuff now, which is why I eat stovetop, like, I make stovetop popcorn, like, 6 nights a week now because I no longer eat sweets.
I think there's only one response to that, Logs.
Whoa.
Mort, you strike me as someone, and I not to make too many assumptions, but you strike me as someone who's maybe of a naturally lean build. Would you notice any differences when you stopped eating sugar?
When you came in, you and you pointed this out. You and Joe Saunders was here, and you're like, we look alike.
Yeah.
He said that.
I thought that was for sure Amy or not another human. That guy looked so much.
You were like, I forgot my glasses, and then you realized that you had your glasses on.
We were dressed the same, too. I was like,
he was dressed very similarly. Yeah. Joe, also of a
very
thinner
lean build. Yeah.
A very lean build.
I think I'm actually a little bit, I think I'm heavier now than I've ever been. It's all right here. I got a little Bart Simpson belly. So I think I actually am a little, this is kind of frustrating. I think I'm a little heavier now that I'm also like, I'm in a loving relationship. So I think I eat more consistently and better now.
Mm-hmm. That can happen.
So that's nice. Cause I think before, I mean, I sort of have the problem where I like, in the past, when I'm not doing well, I eat less.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I have the other thing where I get like skinnier and when I'm, you know, worse. Mm. So I think I'm like healthier now, but I also weigh a little more.
Interesting.
Yeah. Mm. I kind of balloon up no matter what, I guess is what I found. I'm like, hey, here's the time in my life I'm happy. I'm like, I was fucking big. And then I'm like, oh, there I am sad. I'm like, big again. I don't know. There's no, I think I go up and down. I think it just is kind of with the wind, whether I'm up or down. Like, it's probably the same with you, my guess.
It's so hard to change your, like, body style. And I heard this thing the other day. Somebody was talking about this, about, like, when you're trying to lose weight, how important it is to have, like, a ton of compassion for yourself. Because the kind of diet culture sort of sells you this lie that, like, if you do this right, you'll lose weight, and that's it. But the reality is like, you have a relationship with food, which we all do, right?
Yeah.
That needs to be addressed. And that is something like is gonna take 5 years. Like, you're gonna be bigger and smaller and bigger and smaller, you know? And I was like, I think that's like a nice way to think about it.
Mike and I are verklempt right now. Is that the word?
Yeah, verklempt. That's a word. I love this general advocacy for compassion for yourself.
You know, because it's hard, dude. Like, I don't know.
Pretty tricky, because I think that we both kind of like, objectively suck.
Oh, yeah, not you guys.
Good.
No.
Okay, good.
The podcast I was listening to was like, except for those doughboys. They're just lazy.
We'll take a break. We'll be back with more doughboys.
This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. What's up, everybody? It's your boy, the Spoon Man. And you know, there's something I just recently learned about myself.
What's that?
I learned that sometimes I emotionally eat. When I'm emotional, I'm putting food in my mouth. And I'm sometimes trying to cover up, you know, some sadness, some depression with snacking. It happens.
Well, you know, Mitch, getting to know yourself can be a lifelong process, especially because we're always growing and changing. Therapy is all about deepening your self-awareness and understanding, because sometimes we don't know what we want or why we react the way we do until we talk through things. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist who can take you on that journey of self-discovery from wherever you are.
Wise, anytime I've done therapy in the past, I've always been a better person. I feel better. I'm happier, and I want to tackle the world. I always feel great when I'm in therapy, and therapy can also work for you. If you're in a spot where you're trying, you know, you're having some depression, if you have anxiety, therapy, talking to someone can just be great.
Yeah. And hey, if you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule. Just fill out a brief questionnaire to get matched with a licensed therapist and switch therapists anytime for no additional charge. Discover your potential with BetterHelp. Visit BetterHelp.com/Doughboys today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/Doughboys.
Do it. Our next partner is Athletic Greens. I take AG1 by Athletic Greens literally every day. I gave AG1 a try because, you know what? I wanted better gut health, Wags. I wanted more energy. I wanted my immune system to be up. I'm getting sick all the time. I'm coughing and sneezing. I don't like taking a bunch of pills and vitamins. And you know what? I wanted a supplement that actually tastes great. I take AG1 in the morning. I put it in a big glass of water, or I mix it in with my yogurt smoothie. And my day has started, Wags. I'm cooking. It makes me feel unstoppable.
Wow.
Super Mitch.
Wow.
What do you think of that?
Mitch, I think that's just dynamite. I think that's the cat's pajamas. You know, it's hard for me to keep up with a supplement routine that comes with a bunch of different products, but AG1 makes that so much easier. Very quickly, you notice the benefits. Improved digestion, hair and skin feeling great, supporting sleep. Why take a bunch of different things when you can mix one scoop of powder and water once a day? AG1 was designed with ease in mind so you can live healthier and better without having to do a lot.
Wags, it's the healthiest thing you can do in under a minute. AG1 is powerful because it's so easy to fit into your lifestyle. It's one scoop of powder mixed with water once a day. AG1 has been part of millions of mornings since 2010. And AG1 gives you increased energy and mood support, making it easy to live your best life.
Hey, AG1 delivered every month. Easy to make it a daily habit. And you also get them single-serving travel packs. I love the travel packs.
Super handy.
Don't miss a day. Mix the powder into water. Shake it on up. Put it in that shake bottle.
Shake it up.
That's it.
Mm-hmm.
With AG1, taking care of your body each day is really that simple.
You know, for me, I'm like, hey, I got a travel pack. Maybe I'll just I'll head down and see why, because I'll take a travel pack with me.
There you go.
There we go.
Yeah, that's fun.
I'll go down there. I'll knock on your door. You'll be like, I'm not really interested. I'll take off. And I'll still use the pack, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Shaking up my AG1 in there. Leave me alone.
Yeah, shake it on up.
If you're looking for an easier way to take supplements, Athletic Greens is giving you a free 1-year supply of vitamin D and 5 free travel packs with your first purchase. Go to athleticgreens.com/doughboys. That's athleticgreens.com/doughboys. Check it out.
Do it.
Welcome back to Doughboys. We're with Mort Burke. It's time for our final thoughts on Honey Bee Burger. Now,
Fork burp.
Fork, here's how this will work. We'll each go around and give our
fork
scores.
This, here's how this will work.
Fork, this is how this will burp.
Here's what I say. Since we've got Fork with us, I think we should rate out of Morts. 0 to 5 Morts.
Rick, that's a great idea. Still auditioning for that spot.
I auditioned for that too. I was like, it has to count a little that that's my actual name, right? We can at least put me to the top of the fucking list, maybe.
I love that idea, Wags.
Yeah, okay.
I think that's a great idea.
Untouched.
So Fork, touched. We will rate this out of 0 to 5 Morts. Your final thoughts, your closing argument, if you will, on Honey Bee Burger, and end it by giving your Mort score.
Great. As a person who, again, like, kind of am sort of forced to try and find meatless alternatives, I'm real into these kinds of places. I feel psyched to live in a place where I have options like this. So once I found it, and again, I was not expecting it to be good. So I... should I tell the story of why I stopped eating meat?
Yeah, yes.
We can cut it out too if it's whatever. But so I maybe like probably 4 years ago, I started volunteering at the Gentle Barn. The Gentle Barn, Michael.
That's where we met.
We started.
I got brought to the Gentle Barn. I was like, I'm a man, damn it. And then Mort was like, oh, I know this guy. Let him out.
For a man, you're eating a lot of hay.
Well, it's what you fed us.
He ate that whole apple.
That is very noble of you to go do stuff.
I say it because I'm a saint. It's kind of selfish too because some people they go to the spa and they leave and they feel really calm. Like massages, they don't do that shit for me. I don't like to be touched by strangers. Really. So, but going to hang out with because I went there randomly with a friend. And after I left, I hung out with these goats and I felt so calm afterwards. Like I learned that I have this kind of connection to animals. So I started going there and what happened, so they have these cows there that have been genetically altered to be giant. So they're like, whatever, 2,000 pound animals. And so it's this really sad thing, but they take these animals, they save them, and they do all this hilarious stuff. Like they give them massages, they give them like energy work, all that, like perfect food, all this stuff. So you go in there and you can go in and hug this cow. And it really does feel like you're around have you guys been around like a whale or something? Or like a dolphin? Like there are these exotic.
The whale. We've seen the whale.
Character. Been around him.
This was not like, I was sobbing in the same way, exact same way I sobbed at the whale. Anyway, it was just this experience of like, oh shit, these are, and I really like animals. Whatever.
Yeah.
So it was like, and I think it's hard because I, like I said, I've eaten a million cheeseburgers. I do not judge any meeting at all.
Yeah.
But I feel lucky because after I did that a bunch, this thing happened where kind of like the sweets where I was like, fuck, I actually don't really want to eat meat anymore, which was why it was so helpful because I don't think I could have forced myself to stop.
Yeah, right.
Because it's so easy and I love them and it tastes so good. I'd make them myself, like made a really good cheeseburger, you know, whatever. So anyway, we can cut that out if it's
not at all.
Yeah. So once that all that happened, I was like, shit, it's cool. I'm like, it's better for the environment, whatever.
Yeah.
So I like these kinds of places. I'm going Forks giving four morts on this.
Four morts.
Four morts.
Wow. Four out of five morts.
All right, Mitch.
Look, I'm saying this up top. We judge a place but what Wags breaks down everything about it. It's appearance, what it's trying to do.
Yeah.
And I think that this place can take some hits for some of the aesthetics, some of the, you know, the online, the ordering and stuff. But look, when it comes down to it, it is mostly about the food. And what they're trying to do is make vegan-based burgers and chicken sandwiches that are, you know, an approximation of the real thing. And here's a thing also about this place that I think is good and also maybe a reason why this place is that it felt so much more like a homemade sort of meal. Like it had that vibe to it where I was like, oh, this burger has like great taste to it, but it also doesn't feel like Monty's feels like a fast food burger. This feels more like a nicely made vegan burger by like a friend but it was really very good. It was very, very, very tasty. And that's what matters the most is the food side of it. And Wags, a young Mitch and his hot ass mom would be shocked, but I think that I gotta go. I think there's no other way to go but fucking four morts as well.
Four morts. Wow.
I think it's the crazy thing of this place is like probably going to shut down.
I hope it doesn't, but I think it's on the trajectory, yeah.
And I'm like so close. Like there's like a couple things that made me be like, oh, maybe it's 3.75. You know what? I think maybe the frots did it for me.
Yeah.
The frots were hit. Everything I had, I enjoyed. There wasn't a single, and look, we've given four forks to places that have, we've eaten at, and there's like been things where I'm like, I didn't like that. There was nothing here that I didn't like. I liked everything I ate.
Yeah.
So four forks.
Four morts.
Four morts.
Four morts so far.
Four morts.
From our guest and from my co-host. If Apodaca was here, this place would not be getting in the Golden Plate Club.
Wow.
He gave it 3.5 forks, which translates to 3.5 morts by our scale. His review was...
interesting.
Yeah.
I'd have to say maybe a 3.5. Burger was pretty good. Fries were good. And I think this is what skews his score down. Previous shake, truly horrid. He had a really bad experience with the fake chocolate shake he had. Mm. But vegan ranch was good. He also notes that.
Mine was fucking good. I don't know what the fuck he's talking about.
I did have a great shake. I did have one menu item I didn't love, which was the mac and cheese. But everything else.
Yes. The mac and cheese was the weakest of the game, but I didn't I didn't dislike it. I just... Mm-hmm.
I wish they would just not do it.
That's what
I think.
Yes.
We're just better at being like, this doesn't work for us. Take it off the menu.
That feels like a thing that they kind of feel like the way their menu copy reads, it feels like that offering the mac and cheese is like a point of pride for them. But I kind of feel like, yeah, it would be addition by subtraction to get it out of there. But, or maybe there's a better execution of it that you know, they'll figure out. But based on everything else I had, The premise of the podcast is like, how's this, what you were touching on, Mitch, like, does this place accomplish what it's setting off to do? And this place is trying to be a vegan Shake Shack approximation. Absolutely succeeds there. I really enjoyed my meal. I thought my food was great. And I'm not going to go below 4 morts, which means it's in the Golden
Mort Club.
Wow. Congratulations.
The Golden Mort Club?
The Golden Mort Club.
It should be the Golden Burp Club.
The golden Plate Burp.
The golden Plate Burp.
Congratulations.
Wow.
Mort, thank you for bringing this place to us. This was a lot of fun to eat at and talk about.
What was the name of the place? What was the farm you went to called?
Oh, the Gentle Barn.
The Gentle Barn.
Yeah, yeah.
That's rad.
Mm-hmm.
Well, hey, that was our review.
I was trying to think of it, and I was like, was it called the Tender Bar? And then that's an Affleck movie. Mm-hmm. Affleck movie. I sound like I said Affleck movie.
You're going to show up the fucking Gentle Barn with a bib.
Do you guys think that the Nick looks more like me than Nick?
I kind of do think Nick looks a little bit like you there.
That's old, but that art was back when I was beardless and had a little bit of a shorter crop hair. And yeah, I'm kind of dressed in Mort cosplay there.
They are so great. I love your art. It's so cool.
Shout out Chris Van Artsdalen.
Chris Van Artsdalen, he really didn't give me any eyes, which is appropriate. but they're really not there.
Look how happy you are with your little spoon.
I know. Yeah. Then it's also I am happier than I normally am.
That part's way off. We're happy.
How about Honeybee Burger? Honeybee Burger.
Sneaky Golden Plate Club, or sorry, Golden Mort Club in Trent.
Only Golden.
That's right.
Golden
but it's plate also burp but it's also entrance. In the Golden Plate Club.
Yeah,
just canonically. Mm-hmm. And if people are in the LA area and are looking for a vegan eatery, check it out. You know, maybe throw it some support.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, that was our review of Honeybee Burger. It's time for a segment. I've got some.
Do you like it more than Monty's?
Mm.
Tough question.
I'd had Monty's so many more times, and I kind of know what to order at Monty's. I don't have the same relationship with Honeybee. I mean, your advocacy for this place over Monty's makes me want to go back.
I do like it more than Monty's, personally. Yeah. I will say the Monty's nuggets are kind of crushing it for me right now. But and then this place, that's what was wild, is their burger, their like chicken sandwich that I had was different.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was this time, and it was really good both times. Yeah, I go Honeybee every time. I will say this, too. I didn't mention this. I think this is probably... I imagine this is like across the board true. It is a little overpriced.
Sure.
You know what I mean? They shouldn't be like $13 or whatever.
Well, that's the fucking, so much of that is just like American agribusiness of just like the, you know, the fucking meat and dairy industries are so subsidized that they can sell things at absurdly low prices and they don't have to. It meat is way too cheap for the impact it has on the environment and for, you know, a big part of it is just how shittily they can handle animals and process them that it lowers their
cost. How many
their
of
costs.
Them they can kill in front of their children.
Exactly. That's really, really gnarly shit. Well, God bless you for volunteering at the Gentle Barn.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm looking up I'm trying to see what we gave. What scores we gave.
We were pretty high on Monty's. We had a good experience. Well, the thing I'll say about Monty's, they've really figured out their branding.
Yeah, like
it's
that's
really,
right.
You really dialed
that
in.
I gave Monty's five forks. You gave Monty's five forks.
Wow.
We did Monty's with Evan Susser.
That's right. It was for our Shake Shack episode.
And Sus gave it 3.75 forks.
Yeah, it's on brand.
Mm. He's a little grumpy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe I like Monty's more, but I don't know. I don't eat vegan, like I don't eat vegan burgers as much as you do.
So I'd have to have Honeybee more to have like a one-to-one comparison.
I've had Monty's more than I've had Honeybee, but I've had Monty's probably 6 times or something.
Hey, more the merrier as far as I'm concerned. Hey, I've got some hot button food topics, and we'll be judge, jury, and executioner. It's another edition of Food Court.
Is there a song or something?
Gunk, gunk, gunk. Yeah.
Oh, there should be a song.
Well, what was this? What did you do?
I don't know. I was like, I should do like some sort of gavel motion or something, but then I didn't.
That's what that was?
Well, I was like, I didn't want
to. My improv nerd kicked in where I was like, I guess I have to make the sound for this.
I didn't want to hit the table because then I'd knock my Yeti mug over.
Which you did spill during lunch, too, by the way.
Yeah, I spilled my mug during lunch.
Anya had to give you shout wipes.
Yeah, there's still a little stain on my pants. It's all right.
Interesting.
Wait, can I say another a Doughboy? I don't know why I keep asking permission. I do a Doughboys-esque phrasing that I say sometimes before I eat that I think you guys, like my partner doesn't love it because I say it so much, but yeah. I go, don't mind if I chew.
Right. Fuck, that's so good. That's good. Really good.
I thought you guys would like that.
That is good.
It should be like a like dun dun yum 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 yum.
Really harrowing minor chords.
And still, is that bass? What is that? Is that the bring bring? There's some good guitar or bass in there.
It's just a little synthy, I think.
Okay, yeah. Get that in there still too.
Yeah,
is someone going to make this? Or you?
Yeah,
just...
so we'll make it. Someone will make it. In the criminal justice system, food-based crimes are considered the most egregious.
Special victims food unit.
There you go.
You and I are precogs, and we're in gravy tubs.
You gotta refill the tubs again. All right, here's how this will work, Fork.
We will just drink.
I think there's going to be a murder, but I need more gravy to be able to tell. Fork, here's how this will work. I will give a topic, and then we will all just collectively weigh in and try to render a decision. First up.
I like this.
And these topics are all from our associate producer, Emilio Marino.
Oh, Jesus.
What? What's
that? They're going to be insane.
No, these are good topics.
Okay.
Bagel and lox. Open face or sandwich together?
I got a take.
Yeah, go for it.
Open faced.
Wow.
You got to go open faced.
Wow.
Look, here's the thing is that like that turns it into like is lox raw? And it's
lox? Like smoked
it's
usually.
Smoked.
Yeah.
I don't know. It turns into like a sandwich. And I don't know, on top of the cream cheese. It's such a layered thing to me that I think that it's got to be open face. I'm an open face guy on there. Wow. And I don't love open face sandwiches, but for bagels and lox. You know what? Like, there's been times where I've gotten a bagel sandwich with cream cheese and I've eaten it, like, as the sandwich. It's not as good as having the two halves. Wow. That's the fun about bagels. You slice them in two.
Mm.
Open face.
Wow.
I think I'm with you a little bit that generally I prefer because that makes me, okay. Bagels and lox is such a traditional thing that I think traditionally I think it is open faced. So I wouldn't want to touch that. I think I wouldn't want to mess with that history. But that makes me think of like avocado toast.
Oh yeah.
Which I can be a sloppy eater. It's sliding all over the place. Okay. That's why I generally like a closed face situation just because.
Sloppiness factor is huge.
Mm-hmm. But I think with the bagels and lox, I think the cream cheese does a good job of sort of centering the lox. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, sure.
It's more adhesive, I think.
Kind of the fly tape of the food world is the cream cheese. Gets stuff stuck. Right?
Yeah, no, that's a good... Look, these are Thank all good you. Arguments. I'm going to have a third option here, which is that lox, get out of here.
You know what?
I don't need that with my bagel.
Lock them up. Yeah. I don't need them.
Lock them up.
I don't fucking need
them. I don't
locks.
Need it.
I prefer a bagel without locks.
Yeah.
I'm the same way.
Wow. Well, there you go.
I generally don't like smoked things oftentimes.
Yeah.
I mean, look.
Except
I,
for the ganja, buddy.
Whoa. I didn't know we partied.
Well, clearly you can tell he does not. There was a very funny thing where he was like, hey, Gabrus, we were on a text chain together. And he's like, I got some weed things to like, put myself to sleep every night, and then one of the weed things you got were they coffee beans?
They were chocolate covered.
They were
espresso beans.
Oh no!
And then you guys were like, "Hey, that has caffeine in it. It would be counterproductive." I was like, "Oh man, didn't think about that."
You're gonna eat espresso beans to go to sleep?
Yeah, it didn't work out.
That your impression of smoking weed was like what like a Republican congressman thinks that teenagers do. Ganja, buddy.
There's overlaps with Gates quite a bit.
Yeah.
You know what? Get rid of lox. Get rid of it. Wait, what is this? Oh yeah, the smoked stuff. I don't like smoked stuff that much either.
I'm okay
even with
smoked
barbecue,
stuff, but
like
I don't
when it's too smoked, I'm like, sure. Get out of here.
Yeah, a natural smoke I like, but whatever, like the smoky, you know, like flavoring they do, I'm over it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm with you.
Next topic: onions on burgers, raw or cooked?
Wow, you know what? Wags, shout out to our boy Armin, who's he's on the road to recovery. He's doing well.
That's right.
And if you get the In-N-Out burger, you get it the Armin way, which is both. My answer is fucking both.
You can do that. It's an
option. Why the fuck not?
Whoa. That's this... it's like the Frotz question. Why not?
Why not both?
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Both.
I'm going to say, I think this is that's a good answer.
Wait,
but...
is this for sandwiches in general or burgers?
No, burgers. Specifically burgers.
Okay.
I really like raw onion on a burger. I honestly kind of feel like it's like raw white onion on a burger is just kind of either diced up or just a big fucking slice. There's something about that that just like really kind of pierces
Look,
through in a nice.
I prefer raw onions to cooked. I'll say that, but you can have both.
Yeah, you can have both.
I'm going to be a little bit contrarian here. Now, growing up, the only fast food we ever got, again, we were poor, so it makes me very, a very noble person. in Gender Bar, don't forget. But we only got White Castle was the only the only fast food until I was like probably 12 or something. So I've got and just the way cooked, if I'm cooking anything, if I start cooking the onions, I like, so there's something about that taste that I prefer. So I'm gonna go cooked.
Wow.
It's funny though because those like small cooked, they're like, it feels like they're not cooked very long. You know what I mean? They're like, it's like a nice kiss on the grill.
Yeah.
Where like sometimes I think like the over caramelized onions that where they get sloppy, those are like, that's when I like them the least. It's like when they're like the sloppy caramelized. Like if they're like onions that are just chopped up and they're like warmed up on the, like I'm thinking of White Castle. Those aren't like goopy. Yep. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Yep.
So I think goopy are my least favorite version.
I'm with it. Yeah, like they get long and they're like
stringy,
wet.
Yeah.
I did.
Mm-hmm. Nope.
This isn't a question here, but this may perhaps as a man who spent some time in Chicago, you might have perspective on this. Mm. Pivoting from burgers to its grill mate, the sausage or the hot dog.
Mm-hmm.
A hot dog for me is only raw onions. Like, I don't want the grilled onions on there. I don't want the caramelized onions.
But that's funny, though, because...
But, like, peppers and sausage, I can kind of...
Wags, you're saying no to the L.A. dog.
Mm.
I do like that a lot, but I don't know. I still like the... Wow. That's kind of the peppers and sausage sort of thing.
And
but
that's the Chicago style,
that's
right?
The Chicago, yeah, but I like the fucking... I just love that diced white onion on
I think
a hot dog.
Specifically, if you're saying hot dogs, I want raw onion.
Yeah.
But sausage, I can sometimes have some cooked onions on
Yeah.
there.
I'm pretty simple when it comes to a dog. I really like a sweet relish myself. And I'll do the other stuff. I'll do a little spicy mustard.
Sure.
I'll do other stuff on there. But I never got into the big, giant sesame seed bun, huge cartoon-style sausage. Again, kind of hard to eat for me.
A little hard to eat. I agree with that. Are you a Chicago guy, no ketchup on the hot dog or?
Raised in St. Louis, so that's not really a thing for
me. Right.
You know, they really
a little overboard.
They die on that hill real hard.
Yeah,
who cares?
They're too hardcore about it. Let
me
ask you
this. So you're
fine
with Steve Bartman, too. You're cool with Bartman?
Really close to Bartman. I would say I saved his life after that.
you ushered him out of the stadium.
He stayed with me for a couple of years.
Do you have, as someone who doesn't eat meat, do you have a plant-based dog you like?
I think Not Dogs is a great name for those products. But not
dogs is good.
I probably haven't had a fake hot dog in a really long time. I could go get more into it, I think, actually.
I've struggled to find one that's all that good.
Yeah.
I don't know why it's so much tougher than something that's browned, but
again, that's why, again, the spicy, crispy brown is why the chickens are great. You know what I mean?
Yes,
it's going to take a long time before they really nail what a hot dog tastes like. You know?
We came down to two names for the show is Doughboys and Spicy Crispy Brown, and Doughboys won out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's what I'm always looking for. I like that crunch. I like the salty crunch.
Mm-hmm.
Spicy brown.
It's not too late to change it.
We could change it. We might as well change it. What were some of the other fucking shitty names we had?
My favorite was we made it into a segment and just the alternate history where we named the show this and whatever happened with it is fun to think about. A Sight of Guys.
Jesus.
Welcome to Sight of Guys. I'm Nick White.
Side of guys.
That sounds like, yeah, that's the name of a gay porno that takes place at a restaurant.
Fucking whale is watching it. This is perfect. Okay, next topic. Raised donuts or cake donuts?
Raised donuts or cake donuts?
Yes. I'll fucking lead off on this one. Raised donuts.
Agreed.
Raised.
Agreed.
Raised by donuts.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, gotta be. All right,
I thought you were saying raised donuts, like R-A-Y-S, and I didn't know what the fuck you were talking about.
Yeah, I had to think about what raised donuts were. I've never called them that before, but now I know what you mean. The ones that aren't like the cake. They're like the Krispy Kreme
style. Non-cake.
Raised. I should have let it hit the raised. D a little harder. Raised.
Raised donuts.
Raised.
I will say raised. That there are like, there's like a chocolate cake donut that can be very good.
There's cake donuts I like. I would if I was like I had to pick one. There's cake donuts I'd be sad to see to let go forever. But if I had to pick one of the two, yeah, give me.
Can
a
I give my donut goat?
Yeah.
Chocolate frosted, classic chocolate frosted.
My friend, one of my really good friends in high school, Paul Kingston, shout out Paul, had this really wonderful idea for a donut restaurant where they served what were they? Flat Johns. They weren't long johns. They're flat.
I like that a lot.
Oh, that's fun. Way.
Yeah.
I like that a lot.
Yeah.
Speaking of the longer donuts, speaking of the long boys, my goat nut might be a maple bar. I fucking love maple bars. They're so fun.
Interesting.
That's a taste you can't really get anywhere else.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm. It's really specific.
Mm-hmm. Like that would be an interesting ice cream because the gooey butter cake ice cream has me think about what is other stuff that's not ice cream flavors that could be.
I was talking about this in the Doughboys Discord, the Doughscored Wags.
That's right.
We had a big long conversation about this. This is what happens in the Discord. Are donuts, and this is like is hot dog a sandwich type question? It's annoying, but are donuts dessert?
Right.
And I'm like, you do get served donuts as a dessert. Mm. It does happen. It is like is, and then I was like also thinking I was like when I was a kid I go to Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah.
I get a coffee I wouldn't usually get a coffee, I get like a culotta or something.
Sure.
I get a bagel sandwich and then I get a chocolate frosted. And I did eat the donut last. Here's the thing is that sometimes you only have a donut and is a donut a dessert? I think donut is kind of a breakfast dessert. I think it is maybe just I was always been sneakily a dessert, but I don't know what you think.
These discussions of taxonomy get so tricky.
I know.
I think it's not a dessert. I think you can't, like, if you're going to a place and they're like, hey, we have some, you know, we have some frosted mini donuts as a dessert, but you'd be like, oh, okay, that's fine. But you'd also think like, oh, that's kind of a take on dessert. That's kind of like a restaurant thing.
It's just breakfast.
It's a breakfast thing. It's a breakfast pastry. It's a bear claw dessert. No, it's an easy no.
Right. If you eat it first thing in the morning, standard, it's not dessert.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I do think when you're eating it with breakfast, like I like it at the end.
So I agree with that. Mm. I agree with that.
What about like, do you do the same thing with a pancake? Do you do pancake at the end? Like with the syrup on it?
You know what? I kind of do that. Usually a lot of the times when I get pancakes.
Yeah, I will.
The Quincy guys were here and we did table cakes. We did a ton. We did some table pancakes. And that was a thing that we were all eating at the end.
Mm-hmm. Our HeadGum mate, Ian Carmel, that's the thing he advocates, the pancakes for the table.
It's great.
Mm-hmm. Fun to do because it's like you order like pancakes for yourself. You have like two pancakes. You're like, Jesus Christ, I'm wrecked for the day.
Yeah, right. Totally.
It's so tough. But yeah, you might enjoy a quarter of a pancake you share with the party.
And I feel like in continuing with this conversation we're having, I feel like pancakes have gotten bigger and thicker.
Yes.
From what I'm seeing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you're especially wrecked after three of those.
Yeah, that's gnarly.
Things are getting bigger and thicker these days. It's just the way things are going.
Side of guys.
All right, hey, speaking of stuff that is possibly a sweet treat you'd have first thing in the morning, cereal.
Mm.
Pour milk first or pour cereal first?
Oh, easy for me. Cereal first.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, cereal first.
Who the fuck pours milk first?
That's Joker shit. Yeah. No one pours the milk first. What are you talking about?
Who out there is pouring the milk first? You know psychos.
You know who does, I bet?
Who?
Elon Musk.
I bet you must.
100%. He'd like post a photo of that or a little video of that to like troll people.
Yeah.
Like a...
I fucking love that guy.
Yeah, we love him. He's so good.
Oh,
he's
I
so
love
funny.
His politics.
Politics are great. Extremely funny.
Uh-huh. Have you guys heard he's got a bunch of money? Did you know that?
Yeah, he's got. And having money makes you good.
Fucking yeah, that's cool as fuck.
If you have money, you rule.
So
money's
cool.
Money's cool as fuck.
Yeah, hell yeah, dude.
Shows your worth as a human being. All right, next up. Chips in a sandwich, yes or no? This is a good one.
Here's my answer on this one. Only if the sandwich maker is putting the chips in the sandwich. I don't add chips to my sandwich. I don't add fries to my sandwich. But if the sandwich maker, the mythical sandwich maker, is putting them into the sandwich, like when I went to that spot in New Orleans, which I forget the name of, which sucks that I forget the name of it, but they had that bologna sandwich. I think it had chips in the sandwich.
You're not talking about Giacchino's. You're talking about the Pullman? What the fuck is it?
I'll think of it. You say your answer. I'll get it.
I was just going to say, speaking of sandwich maker, and speaking of young, beautiful moms, my lovely mom, Carrie Weiger, when she would make a sandwich for me as a boy, she introduced me to a peanut butter and jelly sandwich with some potato chips inside. And let me tell you, that is a delight. You get a little bit of salt with that sweet, and you get that crunch. Mm. It is so good. So I'm gonna be yes, but I do think that your little addendum, Mitch, your conditional, that it has to be part of the sandwich maker's intention is valid. So I'll say that. I'll agree with you there.
I think I love chips so much that I don't want them to feel diluted by the sandwich.
That's a great take.
I like that. That's a great point.
Thank you. I love chips, fries, I mean, it's all potato based.
It's all good stuff.
You know what I mean? So good.
But potato versus corn chips, where do you land?
Potato all the time.
Wow. Do you have a favorite
turkey and the wolf, by the way?
Turkey and the wolf.
Turkey and the wolf.
Good name.
It's a sandwich. It's a great spot. Great spot.
Yeah.
Was
do you have a preferred potato chip varietal?
Oh my god! I mean, I love a classic Ruffle. I love a chip and a dip.
Yeah.
I'll do a Ruffle and a French onion dip.
Yeah.
And I think that's from childhood too. I think that stuff you get early is the best.
We found out recently when we did the Fritos Wags during our ongoing. Now it has ended.
We
Spotify
finally finished
Live.
Our 30-week contract, our Spotify Live show.
When we did the Fritos dips, I was like shocked at how good the Fritos dips they were so fucking good.
That's the name of the chips. They're called
like Fritos, and then they have like the Fritos dips
and like the metal can.
Yes, and they're if you try those ever, they're like way better than you would ever think they are. They're great.
It's good shit.
They're
really.
All right, Fork. We've got time for one more. I'll let you decide the topic. We can talk pizza, sandwiches, or brew dogs.
Ooh, I'm going to go. I had Pizza Hut last week. I'm going to go pizza.
Yes.
Eat crust or leave crust?
Eat crust.
Eat all crust.
Right. Let's get on to brew dogs, for God's sakes. Leave crust?
I'll say, though, to be addressed, if you're not eating the crust, there's something wrong with the crust. You got to get a better crust, right?
Yeah. That's a great call. That's like a sign that you should maybe pick a different pizzeria.
Look, I'm saying the only time you're going to leave crust is like you've had four pieces of pizza and you're eating your fifth one, then you're like, I'm done, and you throw down you don't eat the crust. Because, of course, a lot of the times what's before the crust is better than the crust, but you still eat the crust. It's still a part of the pizza, and you get bites of the cheese and the sauce with the crust. Wags, ask the brew dog question, please.
I have a
Amelia, don't waste our time with this shit.
We're going to say don't eat the crust? What are we talking about?
Amelia,
what are we doing here, Amelia?
Am I four, Amelia? I eat the crust.
That's strike two, Amelia. Strike two.
I can't believe you guys are paying her so much money.
We pay you so much, Amelia. This is what you bring us?
She's bought a bunch strike of two. Houses. I know. It's like amazing.
Amelia's great. Last question. Wait, I do one thing. As someone who eats plant-based, or someone who eats doesn't eat meat at least, what are your pizza toppings of choice?
Onions. I'll go onions and green peppers. Fine. I'm a little weird, but I'm weird. I like I like pineapple. I know.
Nothing wrong with that.
Those are my go-tos. But I like a black olive.
Pineapple.
That's
you know
fun.
What? If you add jalapeno on that. On the pineapple, you're doing all right.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's honestly a veggie combo Natalie and I will do is jalapeno, pineapple, and onion. And you know what? Not bad. Not too bad at all.
Got some bacon in there. You're in business.
Yeah.
I haven't been to the tender bar. Fuck the gentle barn.
You gotta hug those cows.
Yeah, I'm here for the tender bar. Licking your lips.
That cow does look tender.
Fucking Affleck's behind the counter. We're in business. I mean, we pay you 58 dough bucks a week. Come on.
All right. And those are only redeemable for a song from you, right?
Yeah, for 1,000 dough bucks, you can get a song from me.
Here's the brew dog one.
Yeah, brew dogs. Let's hear it.
Bottle or can?
This is great.
Yeah, this was really good. Amelia, you're down to one strike.
Yeah, Amelia, you lost a strike with that one. Fuck.
I'll answer. And I say this because my nightly thing I do now, a Heineken Zero. Delightful, delightful little just taste of the fake beer.
Mm-hmm.
It soothes me.
I got my answer.
I prefer that in a bottle.
Zero alcohol or zero?
Zero alcohol.
Oh, wow.
0.0%. Yeah. Uh-huh. That's a big thing. It's 69 calories, and you know what? Works for me just fine.
Yep.
Hell yeah. But you can get that in a bottle, you get that in a can. I prefer in a bottle, so I'm going to say bottle.
Wigs?
Mm-hmm.
I think bottles go last in my ranking. Because I would like a draft before I would get a bottle.
Yeah.
And then also,
of course you want a draft.
I like the can. I think I like can. First of all, cans are fun. They just remind me of youth and cookouts and
sure.
An ice cold can and the and shotgunning, all that sort of stuff. I'm going can over bottle. I like cans.
Wow.
I don't drink, but no surprise there. But I love a bottle. I love bottles. And I hear you saying that does make me realize it is really fun, of course, to pop a can. Like, that's just a fun move. But there's something about the weight and it feels expensive. Like, I feel like a rich man when I'm drinking out of a bottle.
It feels fancy. I like both of them more than plastic, of course. I mean,
get plastic out of here. I don't want plastic.
I have recently been like, I'm going to drink. I think I'm going to become a liquid death guy.
I like liquid death.
I'm going to turn into a liquid death guy.
Yeah, no, that's a good water brand.
Nice.
I like drinking out of a tall boy. That makes that reminds me of my youth.
That's fun, dude. They should put them in 40 ounces.
Oh, that'd be a hoot.
Sick.
Infinitely recyclable is what they say about.
It's nice.
Which is good.
Yeah, it's good.
Nice.
Yeah. Wow. Hey, that was food court.
That was fun.
I think we settled a lot of hot issues there. Just like a restaurant of all your feedback. Let's open the feedback. And today we have an email from Steve. Steve writes, "Hey Doughboys et al." A pair of inmates recently escaped a Virginia jail and were found hours later at a local IHOP.
It's kind of dark and twisted. This is Stephen King?
Yeah, this is Stephen from Maine.
Stephen from Maine, okay.
As an inevitable pair of inmates, wow, what would your jailbreak restaurant and order?
Inevitable.
The one you'd pick if you'd only eaten prison food for years and would soon only again eat prison food. Keep up the good work. All right.
Was it a question mark?
No, it just like the way it was written, I'm kind of like, huh?
How was it written?
Exclamation point.
Oh.
I think that's about you, dude.
So I guess in this scenario, we are knowing like, okay, we've escaped, but freedom is fleeting. We're
going
to be
back.
Caught again. So let's just make the most of it.
And it's a restaurant?
Seems like it's a restaurant.
She's a restaurant. Yeah. Wow.
IHOP is kind of a good choice, but I do feel like you might be able to get
choice.
You might be able to get IHOP approximate food in the joint.
You saying that maybe like, man, to get like a big breakfast at Waffle House would be. I guess it would depend on the type of time of day too. Of course, do you eat eggs more or no?
Yeah, I'll eat eggs.
Okay.
Well, I think part of what that's making me think of though, you Mitch, you saying Waffle House and thinking about the IHOP is one thing you'll miss, not just the food quality in the joint. Is also just like the idea of being in a restaurant.
Yeah.
And maybe I'd rather have Burger King, but there's something about sitting down and being served and having a hot mug of coffee, being deprived of those things, that would be so comforting. Waffle House is a great answer.
Wow.
That's huge, because in my mind, I was like, my answer is probably like most things in this podcast, either pizza or McDonald's.
Taco Bell?
Taco Bell too, but like I think that if I was locked in jail, I'd be like, I want like a fucking Big Mac or something.
Yeah, sure.
I want fries.
Yeah.
But your thing of like sitting down and eating a meal, like you would kind of want, and like have someone bringing you food.
Nice.
That seems pretty great. I don't know. Maybe it would be. Maybe just as Waffle House.
Good answer.
I like that's a solid answer. I this is making me realize that I'm
the people in there are like, oh, you smell like shit. Did you like escape from like a sore pipe? And we're like, no.
You're wearing a handcuff that's cut in half. But I realize here's another thing about me. Whenever I'm done eating at a restaurant, I want to leave immediately. It's like almost
interesting.
Yeah. Okay. If I'm at a diner with friends, maybe after like a comedy show, that's cool. I'm down to like hang and talk. That's fun. But so I'm realizing I maybe am not that into, like, I didn't notice the honeybee design. So my go-tos right now, what I would like to do, did you guys ever have Ricky's Fish Tacos?
Yes.
I've not had Ricky's Fish Tacos.
I've had them. They're
it's
great.
It's gone now.
Mm. Wait, it's gone?
Yes. As far as I know, it's this singular taco truck in LA that made the best, like, crispy fish tacos, really fresh onion, pepper thing.
You know what sucks is that I don't think I ever had a lobster taco from there.
Neither did I. I would just do the fish.
Fuck.
It's like my...
Ricky's is gone?
I think so. I mean, you know, let the people write in if I'm wrong, but I think so.
Wow.
That's tough.
I thought for sure that dude was going to open like a super popular restaurant.
Brick and mortar or something. Yeah.
Because he was like very highly rated too. Like, anyway, so that Ricky's Fish Tacos. That's where I'd go.
That's a great answer.
Mm. Rick and mortar kind of sounds like Rick and Morty.
It does.
Yeah.
I can't believe we didn't get those roles.
We should have been the new Rick and Morty.
Yeah.
This is that what you were just saying is making
fuck,
me think
what
of
the fuck fork. What the fuck is going on, fork?
Whoa, like zoinks. That's what it says. Right? Yeah.
What you're just saying is making me think of like going like sitting down at like a like an old school Mexican restaurant. Like that's really fun and that's a really good experience. And that's the kind of thing that I'd maybe have some nostalgia for. But you know what I'm going to say, Mitch? You know I'm going to make my answer, and this is related to you. Imagining if we're the inmates. The old school pizza parlor is a blast. I think if we went to like a Desano, got some big pies,
that would be
just
a
just sort of sat around with some pitchers of cola.
That's a good have a afternoon great or evening answer.
Yeah.
They serve them in the big black skillet thing and put it on the.
Oh, that's a hoot. Oh, like a BJ's. Go to BJ's. Get yourself a fucking Pazookie.
Oh,
what a hoot that would be.
Yeah, real laugh.
Oh, Rick, I don't know. I think that he apologized. I think justice was served. Anyway,
if you have a question or comment about the world of
that was, was it hashtag justice is served?
It was just it was the caption hashtag was simply justice. It wasn't even a hashtag. It was all lowercase justice. Very odd. Email us at doughboyspodcast@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail at 830-GO-DO. That's 830-463-6844. And you can get the Doughboys Double or Weekly Bonus episode by joining the Golden or Platinum Play Club at patreon.com/doughboys. Fork Burp, a.k.a. Mort Burke. Thank you so much for joining us. What an absolute delight to have you on the podcast.
Was I right to hype
Mitch, you were right. Please come back, Mort. This was a blast. Thanks for sharing Honeybee with us. Anything you would like to plug at this time?
Yeah, my special is going to be out by the time this comes out on YouTube and Apple Music and Spotify. It's called Spiritually Filthy. I'm very proud of it. Thank you so much, you guys, for having me.
Thanks for being here, dude.
I'm so glad you liked it. Tons of fun.
This is great.
Yeah.
Check out that special.
Yeah.
And you know what? You don't have to tune back into the show anymore.
Mitch and I have to go back to prison. That'll do it for this episode of Doughboys. Till next time, for the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell, I'm Nick Weiger. Happy eating.
See ya. What's up, everybody? On the next Doughboys Double,
we're joined by senior analyst from Technomic, Andy Ross, to go over the newly published annual list of the top 500 chain restaurants.
Who will claim the title for number one chain?
And what does AUV mean? Find out next week at patreon.com/doughboys.
That's patreon.com/doughboys. See you there.
Sources for the intro are in the episode description.
That was a HeadGum Podcast.